the first trip ever to the state championship for Carmel of Mundelein. They'll have to win without their starting quarterback. Bloomington coming back from a 31-0 loss in the state championship a year ago. They try to avenge that here today. And welcome to Memorial Stadium on the campus of the University of Illinois here in Champaign. 6A IHSA State Football Championship football coming your way as the Corsairs of Carmel of Mundelein take on the Bloomington Purple Raiders. Both teams undefeated coming into this ball game. Carmel making their first appearance here, but tragic, sad news at least for them. Mark Venegoni, their starting quarterback, will not be able to play today. One more hurdle for them to clear here today. A very talented Bloomington team coming back from a disappointing loss in the state championship a year ago. Now let's go upstairs to today's announcers.
Thank you very much, Lee. And you know, this 6A championship game, Jack, really matches the speed of Bloomington and the deception of Carmel.
It really is kind of a unique scenario. There's tremendous speed with Bloomington from a lot of different sources. And yet, on the other hand, if you turn your head from a second with Carmel, you won't be able to find the football. Deception is tremendous for Carmel. We're in for a heck of a ball game here.
That speed of Bloomington, I'm not sure if they use that speed to get down I-74 to get to Champaign, but here is their road to Champaign here in the 6A championship game. They've done it 2 years in a row. First of all, the blowout win over Kankakee. Tough ball game against Rock Island. Then they had to beat Normal Community for the second time of the year. And then the one that maybe stunned a few people, but in a dominating performance in Chicago against St. Rita. James Wade rushed for 194 yards in that 20-7 win over St. Rita. Now, as far as Carmel is concerned, all these guys do is score points, averaging 45 points per game in the playoffs. Now, Mark Venegoni, we'll talk about him. He will not play today. You heard Lee talk about that. He accounted for 6 touchdowns in that first round win over Notre Dame. A tough ball game in Rockford over Boylan High School. And then last week against Minooka at home, it was the defense that really stepped up for the Corsairs, forcing 6 Minooka turnovers. Bloomington, we talk about the tremendous speed they have. They've got speed on both sides of the ball, offensively and defensively. Offensively, for Bloomington, it starts with James Wade. He was here in this championship game last year against Mount Carmel. He was a subpar in that ball game. Ended up breaking his wrist. They did not know about it, but he rushes for 2,000 yards.
Well, you know, you don't need your wrist when you're carrying the football, and he's got great legs, and on this turf, he's really going to show us some action here because he is one of the top running backs in the state.
Justin Harrison, we'll see him on both sides of the ball. You will never see number 22 in the white jersey leave the field. Justin Harrison is described by many as flat out an animal.
Well, you know, everybody they played against this year said he's one of the top players. And when you watch a game or you watch it on tape, when you have to look at your program and say, who the heck is that kid? You know you've got a great player, and he is a great player.
Carmel has been ranked number one all season long in both the Chicago area and statewide, and they do it because of their offense. Now, without John Venegoni or Mark Venegoni, they will have to go to John Popovich, the fullback. He will be crucial today.
Well, you know, he's a big ball carrier. He keeps everybody honest inside. His stats right there, obviously, he's over 1,000 yards and 15 touchdowns. But in this kind of an offense, the fullback is key because he keeps everybody tight and off the perimeter.
A lot of people ignore the defense for Carmel. All they do is knock people down. They fly to the ball. They've got some linebackers that can really spotlight things here as far as Carmel is concerned. And, of course, they can do it up front big, but the linebackers and Larson, he's huge.
Well, they really are, and they've got a great group. And during the week, they get some tremendous practice at it because if they don't know where the ball is, they're in trouble during the week. They go against this type of offense all the time. Their backfield has great speed, but I don't know if they can match it in practice with what they're going to see today.
So now you talk about the effects of Mark Venegoni, the loss that he will have on this team. He has led them for 2 years. He is the person that runs the machine, in Coach Andy Bitto's word. It will fall on John Solon's shoulders. He is the backup quarterback. He is a junior. Game plan-wise for the Corsairs here today, it has to change with a backup in this game.
But not dramatically. You know, he's worked during the week at practice. Put the brunt of the game on the shoulders of the people that have gotten you here. The running backs, the offensive line. Limit what he has to do. Don't put him in situations where there's a lot of pressure. He's got a great surrounding cast around him to take the pressure off.
We're looking for a great one here in the 6A championship game, but first, let's meet the starting lineups. And for that, we go to our public address announcer, Jeff Fritzen.
things. So in battle, we can engage. I strike.
Ladies and gentlemen, here are the starting lineups for the Class 6A State Football Championship. First, from Mundelein Carmel, head coach Andy Bitto. And now the starting lineup for the 13-0 Corsairs at defensive end, number 55, Jaron Rutledge. At nose guard, number 52, Joey Parisi. At defensive end, number 33, Sean Murnane. At linebacker, number 39, Patrick Kimner. At linebacker, number 42, Jordan Snitzer. At linebacker, number 53, Billy Maloney. At linebacker, number 21, Jim Magna. At cornerback, number 20, James Luby. At cornerback, number 80, Jason Cosgrove. At strong safety, number 85, Jack Simmons. And at free safety, number 9, Matt Despain. And now the starting lineup for the Purple Raiders of Bloomington High School. First, head coach Rigo Schmelzer. At end, number 1, Adrian Arrington. At tackle, number 54, Dan Petty. At guard, number 61, Bryce Henneberg. At center, number 50, Mikey Kelch. At guard, number 65, Greg Higby. At tackle, number 64, Eric Miller. At end, number 87, Tim McAvoy. At quarterback, number 4, Jeremy Peden. At running back, number 7, James Wade. At receiver, number 17, Brandon Hughes. And at running back, number 22, Justin Harrison.
Undefeated teams, Bloomington making the repeat visit here to Champaign. The keys to the game, first of all, for the Purple Raiders.
Well, misdirection, how do you ever get ready for that? Well, it's just something that you're going to have to work on during the week, but that's really important. Turf war, you know, they both played on the turf before, but speed really comes out on this kind of a turf and attacked a new quarterback. I don't know that Carmel's going to give them a chance to. They're going to try and keep him away from the ball as much as possible.
As far as Carmel is concerned, they have come oh so close in recent years. Now that they're here, their keys to the ball game look like this.
Well, this is going to be a big loss. Can everybody else pick up where he's left off? Confidence and soul, and I think the rest of the guys will come around him. The offensive line is going to play a real big role in this, and of course, speed kills this. Turf makes everybody faster. You and I could probably put on a show here.
Careful, careful.
But this will be a match of really great skill kids on a perfect surface.
Those of you at home that are nestled nicely into your living rooms, the weather here not as brutal as we had last year. However, it's already impacted this ball game. Carmel won the toss, and so often we see the team that wins the toss defer their selection to the second half. Well, the Corsairs said, you know what? We are going to kick off. We are going to take the wind, which is probably 15 to 20 miles an hour. It will be directly at the backs of the Carmel Corsairs. Bloomington here for the second time in 2 years. Last year, very disappointing performance. They lost in the championship game to Mount Carmel of Chicago, 31 to nothing. Obviously looking for a bit different outcome here today and really fired up after that huge win in the semifinals over St. Rita. Chris Miller will kick off. He is an all-state punter and he has lined it up at the 40-yard line. Deep for Bloomington. John Hammond and James Wade. And we'll start this from the 20-yard line. Offensively for Bloomington, they'll go this way. Very small offensive line, very inexperienced offensive line. Dan Petty is a returning starter. In terms of Henneberg, Kelch, Higby, and Miller, they will be outsized today. The skill positions. Look out, folks. These guys can fly. Jeremy Peden's a quarterback. Interesting story there. He won the quarterback job in week number 1. James Wade rushes for 2,000 yards. Justin Harrison for 1,000. Brandon Hughes, the wide receiver, state quarter champion.
starting from the 20. Harrison, carry number one for 8. Defensively, for the Carmel Corsairs, you saw them introduced on the field moments ago. Sean Murnane, Joey Parisi, and Luis Cuevas are up front. Three of one of each class in that defensive line. Linebackers and secondary, now these guys can hit. They fly to the ball. Magna, Kiminer, Larson, and Maloney will all get to the ball. And in the secondary, you have playmakers. Jack Simmons will go both ways. He can do it. Jason Quasigrove with great speed. Second and a couple. Wade's first carry of the day. He will come up short. Luis Cuevas there. James Larson as well, we talked about him earlier on. Here you take a look at the size difference, and it will be spotlighted more when Carmel has the ball offensively. Bloomington averages 201 pounds, and of course, Mundelein, they play a three-man front. They go 198. Inches away from a first down. Wade has it. Jack Simmons comes up from his safety position to make the stop, and up for Bloomington puts that first down on the board.
That was just a great open field tackle against an outstanding open field runner. That was a great technical play.
So we mentioned Wade, number 7. You see the 7 in the footballs on his helmet. He rushed for 194 yards. And that's pretty good rushing team right there, averaging 292 yards on the ground. Don't ignore Jeremy Peden. He can throw the ball at about 97 yards per game. As you can see, they like to run. And they run the option. Matt Despain, number 9, came up to slow that one down. Then it was James Larson that finished him off.
You got to get to the point of attack real quickly to force them to cut back. And when you cut back, those linebackers better be there in a good pursuit angles.
Matt Despain, number 9, 5'11", 155 pounds, senior safety. And that will be his responsibility today, is to slow down this option attack. Here are your numbers for Bloomington. Their numbers in the playoffs declining a little bit on the offensive side, but take a look. They've only allowed a list shade over 8 points defensively here in the 4 games that have led to this 6A championship. Now Harrison will go in motion. And he will be the lead blocker for Hughes. He's got breakaway speed.
Bye-bye.
Brandon Hughes to the 30. He's gone. 70 yards on the touchdown pass. About a 2-yard pass. Hughes did the rest. He averages over 32 yards per catch, and he showed you why.
That was just a great call. It was a bubble screen to the outside to get him out in the perimeter and isolate him on single coverage, and that speed pays off in the open field.
Peden doubles as the kicker for the Purple Raiders. We talked about the speed. You saw the speed. Bloomington, in what they could not do in 4 quarters last year, has put 7 on the board. 2.5 minutes in the ballgame, 7-0. Bloomington on top of Carmel in the 6A state championship ballgame. Jamison to kick off for the Purple Raiders to get things started. We have only played just a shade under 2.5 minutes here in the opening quarter, and Bloomington has struck first. He will go short, very short.
It's a live ball too.
Brandon Hughes, dynamite.
This is a bubble screen on the outside. They're stretching the perimeter. You can see where he throws it backwards, and it's a screen right there. It's a nice block. But here's where this tremendous speed comes in. When you're isolated on the corner one-on-one, you're just not going to catch him. And that's what they wanted to do during the season. He averaged 32 yards a catch. That's incredible.
Okay, folks, keep your eyes open. Watch the ball. People have had trouble with it all year in the Carmel offense. John Solon is the quarterback taking over for All-Stater Mark Menegoni.
You know what that play? Excuse me. You know what that play is right there? Get the jitters out of your system. You're in the ball game. Seriously, let him carry it on the first play. Now he's into it.
A huge offensive line Dan Osterhout, the right tackle, is an all-stater, and they open up the holes for them in the backfield. John Solon to start. The wings, Steve Hieronymus and Mike Serio. John Popovich has rushed for over 1,000 yards. Don't ignore Jack Simmons or Chris Miller. They can hurt you as well. Solon gets 7 on play number 1. Popovich. John Popovich will get it into Bloomington territory. Defensively for Bloomington, they will have to make some adjustments here very quickly. They are very small. Rod Castillo, the man in the middle, he is the nose guard, 5'6", 176 pounds. Matt Logson will go 258, but it's a small defensive front. When you talk about your linebackers, Justin Harrison, maybe the best linebacker in Illinois, he gets help from Dane Ramirez, and then you see Hughes doubling up in that secondary along with Adrian Arrington. First down for Sayers. They run the option out of the double wing. Once again, Popovich. The fullback to the 39.
Now the nose man jumped in the gap and they audible back and came back the other side. But I think what is interesting too for our audience at home, watch the deception and the follow through on all the faking by the Carmel backs. They will go at least 5 to 10 yards down and past the line of scrimmage on all fakes after the ball's given off.
You can see the numbers there. This game will be played on the ground as both teams, that's how they've gotten there. That's how we have 26 wins and no losses in this championship game. Second and 7. Solon will have it close to the first down. So they go to the junior backup, a good runner, not as good a thrower as Venegoni. But you know what? He's run, as you said, Jack, he's run the backup teams all year long. It is nothing new for him.
And right now, he's into the ball game. He carried in the first play. He just had a nice run here. He's getting great support from the rest of his offensive teammates. He feels comfortable.
There was some question earlier in the week as to who would be the quarterback. And there you see the size difference. 60 pounds per man, and actually 4 inches in height as well when you tack that on. That's the mismatch that Bloomington will have to battle today. Popovich will get it to the 30-yard line. John Popovich, 1,041 yards. We talked about the story earlier in the week. Dane Ramirez made the tackle. Mike Serio, one of the halfbacks, was battling it out with Solon to be the starting quarterback for this championship ballgame, so much so that Serio was working on his footwork in the basement at home. Instead, he'll stay at his halfback position and hope that he can improve and actually equal those numbers, outstanding numbers for Carmel this year, over 40 yards per game, or 40 points per game. Fresh set of downs. Popovich again, they like the fullback dive.
Well, the other part of that not changing position is you're giving up too many other positions. You'd really be making 2 to 3 position changes. I think it was a great coaching move on his part to go with Solan because he's the backup quarterback. He might not be the greatest athlete to put in there, but he is the backup. He's had the reps there. You take another running back that hasn't been there, and now you're kind of thrown off the entire offense. So I think it was an excellent coaching choice.
Solon, and there may be a little bit of the problem they could have. Darren Davis, number 31, just ran right in to John Solon, and just a little bit of timing here. You had a week to prepare, but just a bit of timing could have been a problem there.
Well, this was great penetration by the defensive line. They just jumped in the gap, and you can see right in here, we're 27, Rod Costello, 5'6", 176 pounds, shaded the inside gap and made a great penetration move and stopped the play.
Now on third down and long, will this be Solon's first pass of the day? He will. He looks for Simmons. Simmons!
Wow.
Touchdown! Jack Simmons, 32 yards on the touchdown reception, and that is why number 85 is headed to the University of Minnesota to play Big Ten football.
Well, what you want to do is you want to isolate a 6'5 man against a 5'10 defender and put him in the corner by himself. But what really made that play is Solon froze the DB with just a dive fake, but he laid the ball up long before Simmons made his break. That was an excellent throw and an even better catch.
Chris Miller looking to tie this one up. Works out of the hold of Simmons. We are knotted at 7, 5:51 to play in the first quarter. Each of these teams have scored on their first possession. Each of these teams have scored on a touchdown pass.
Well, we'll see the dive fake right in here, but this is the key down here. He just runs a fade in here. Remember, he is 6'5". And, you know, he's the one that we want to make sure. Right there's a dive fake that held that corner. And right there he goes up 6'5". Great throw, great catch. Minnesota's got a heck of a football player in Jack Simmons. And he plays both ways, so he's got a lot of versatility to his football game.
This IHSA broadcast is brought to you by Country Insurance and Financial Services. Real people, real answers, real quick. And by Chevrolet and your local Chevrolet dealers. Chevrolet, an official sponsor of the Illinois High School Football Championships. Well, you say you like your offense, folks, then you've come to the right place. The 6A state championship game, Bloomington, Carmel tied at 7. Miller will get things started. Wind at his back. And once again, we will start from the 20-yard line. Well, when you take a look at Brandon Hughes, we see John Hammond. He's a backup running back. He's not got a lot of time, what with Harrison and Wade in the backfield. But when you talk about Brandon Hughes, you talk about James Wade, you talk about Justin Harrison, as Rigo Schmelzer, the head coach for Bloomington, said, you know what? You're not going to find three guys faster on any single team. We've already seen that.
That makes a tremendous defensive situation for Carmel, because they've got three burners they got to cover, and it's tough to do that.
They will have to get after Wade. He gets to the outside. James Wade, a 12-yard pickup on first down. Now, Wade, you take a look at these two men in the backfield. Wade, we said, came into this ballgame with 2,095 yards. That's on a 9.0 yard per carry average. Harrison is fullback. All he does is average 9.3 yards per carry.
That's not too shabby, is it?
That'll get you a free first downs, move the chains a bit.
Plus, if they get tired to go to them, they can go outside to Hughes, who averages 32 points a reception. 32 yards a reception, rather.
One of the reasons they are 13-0. Jeremy Peden, the quarterback. That is Harrison in motion. Room for Wade.
Great.
James Wade, a step away from bursting through.
And that play was made by Justin Harrison. He came out of the backfield in motion and threw a great, great block. We'll watch Justin Harrison here come out of the fullback spot. He's in motion right there at the top of your screen. The pitch, but watch Justin Harrison come to your screen right there. Look at that block. That's what made the play, and that's why Harrison is so highly recruited and regarded as one of the top players in the state of Illinois. Now that is speed when you run out of your shoe.
I think he burned that one up. First down, Bloomington is taking it out to the 44-yard line. Justin Harrison crosses midfield. Now one thing Andy Bitto said, as Jack Simmons was the man on the tackle, Andy Bitto, the Carmel head coach, said, you know, speed does not bother us. And he's talking about his defensive unit. Speed does not bother us, size does. Well, Bloomington does not have the size, but I think you've already seen the speed factor and the impact it's had.
Well, the reason, if the size, but what happens is once they get in those seams, forget about size. Now you have to be able to stop that speed. That's a whole different issue, especially when you get those guys in the open field.
Just a yard short of a first down. Harrison will have it. Jim Magnin, number 21, one of the first men in on the hit. Also down at the bottom of the pile, number 42 is James Larson. Also getting help from number 52, the nose tackle, Joey Parisi.
First down, fourth and at the Carmel 44-yard line.
Bloomington obviously playing with a lot more confidence here today than we saw, Jack, exactly 1 year ago, when Mount Carmel pretty much took it to him, shutting out the Purple Raiders in that ball game 31-0 in the 6A championship game.
Well, if you remember, the weather wasn't too helpful to their particular style of offense.
Peden drops it. First turnover of the day. Billy Maloney, number 53, 6'1", 190-pound senior with the fumble recovery. Here it is.
Well, it happens right here coming out. He never gets the ball. He pulls out too soon because he was going to reverse pivot. And when you do that, your feet go first and your arms stay in there a little too long. And that's exactly what happened. He lost the football, and Carmel is right on the spot. Good field position for Carmel.
Starting at their own 43. Solon will get a couple of yards, that is all. That's interesting because, you know, you work all season long as Justin Harrison, number 22, gets off the bottom of the pile. You work all season long as the backup, And then the time comes where you have to make the reads. They open up the hole for him right there. Man down on the field for Bloomington. Boy, flat on his face, can't quite pick up a number. Here are your turnovers on the season. Now you take a look and you say, well, how can Carmel be 13-0 and they lose 21 fumbles and recover only 13? Well, you know what, you play with the ball like that, you have an opportunity to give the ball up, and that's what the Corsairs have done at times this year.
Exactly, that type of offense lends itself to some mishandling occasionally because there's a lot of faking going on and the ball can end up on the ground. And of course, if you have inclement weather and you're doing that, you're going to have that. But with the type of offense that they have, it then leads to the yardage and the scoring they're able to do. So one offsets the other, and it's more dramatic from the standpoint of what they score and how much yardage they gain.
It appears if it is the man down in the field at about the 48-yard line. Could be. We don't. Well, let's make sure. And we'll get to you that in just a second. But face down in the turf, as we take a look at turnover situation on the day, well, Bloomington's given it up once, and that's what Carmel is looking to capitalize right here. Man down is Tim McAvoy. McAvoy, a 6'5", 245-pound junior, is coaching staff and players for Bloomington look on. McAvoy played last year as a sophomore tight end. He was injured for part of the year. They are looking for big things from him, not just necessarily here in this game or in the season to follow next year, but they think this guy has a great future ahead of him. But right now, he's down at about midfield. Memorial Stadium, the site of the 6A state championships. We've already crowned five state champions. Well, you just witnessed, if you were with us earlier, a great ending to a ball game in the 5A game. Joliet Catholic Academy winning their 11th state championship with a hold on, let your fingernails slide down the cliffs, 27-24 win over Springfield Sacred Heart Griffin. And of course, coming up following this ball game, two more great games, 7A championship matching Oswego against Libertyville. And then in the 8A game, a game that a lot of people, probably the game that more people have talked about than any single game, and that would match the Lockport Quarters against the Maine South Hawks.
I'd almost pay to see that game. We don't have to pay to get up here, do we?
I'll get back to you on that one.
That's going to be a great one.
Memorial Stadium, the site of the Illinois Football Championships. What a great, great facility it is. And yes, indeed, it is an old one.
This landmark Memorial Stadium was dedicated in 1924 to honor the personal sacrifice of 189 University of Illinois alumni, students, faculty, and staff who gave their lives in World War I. Their names are engraved on the limestone columns gracing the stadium. Since World War I, an additional 932 members of our Illinois family have given their lives in our nation's wars and conflicts. In 2002, through the efforts of its alumni, the University of Illinois officially extended the original dedication of Memorial Stadium to honor alumni, students, faculty, and staff who have served and will serve in the United States Armed Forces. The names of the additional 932 Illini who made the ultimate sacrifice are engraved on tablets in the stadium's four towers alongside the names of their fallen World War I comrades. May Memorial Stadium always remind us of the tremendous debt we owe to those who served and died, that we may live and learn in freedom.
And again, this stadium will be continually people filing in, filing out. The lights will take effect, and there it is, the 7A game. Oswego and Libertyville, you're going to have an opportunity to see Santino Panico, one of the outstanding players, an All-American player for Libertyville. And then in the Class 8A game, well, if you're going to get your popcorn around you, make sure you have a big bowl because you're going to be there a while, folks. These two teams will throw it with the two best quarterbacks in the state. As far as our ball game here this afternoon, Bloomington and Carmel. Bloomington, of course, just down the road, McLean County, population 51,000. Big 12 Conference, four straight times the Purple Raiders have won the Big 12. Then the other side, long trip from Mundelein. That's in the northern suburbs, 21,000 population in the town. They are just, and ironically, they are just literally down the street, just a couple miles apart from Libertyville, the team that will be playing the 7A game. Enrollment about 1346, East Suburban Catholic Conference. And if that sounds familiar, well, that's the conference that Joliet Catholic Academy is from as well. Let's go down to the sidelines now and check in with our sideline reporter, Lee Hall.
All right, guys, you guys were talking about the great history of Memorial Stadium, Zupke Field here, and there you see Red Grange's image high above the stadium. If you come down, it's way behind the bleachers and things, so you can't really see it, but a really nice plaque and memento here to one of the first stars to ever play in this stadium, Red Grange, the Galloping Ghost. He had one of the first really great performances here, and on this plaque, upon seeing Grange's performance, legendary sports writer Grantland Rice penned this immortal verse: a streak of fire, a breath of flame, eluding all who reach and clutch, a gray ghost thrown into the game that rival hands may never touch. A rubber-bounding, blasting soul whose destination is the goal, Red Grange of Illinois. One of the first stars here at the University of Illinois to make his name here at Memorial Stadium. Back upstairs to you.
You know, it's interesting, of course, this was the home, Memorial Stadium, the home of the Chicago Bears last year while Soldier Field was being renovated. They have, as we saw, Red Grange up here along the side of the scoreboard, but they also have Dana Howard, Dick Butkus, and Jim Grabowski. Now, those were four different players that were up here last year. Last year, they tried to make the tie-in between the University of Illinois and the Chicago Bears. This year, they allowed the students to vote for who they wanted to have go up there. As we take a look at Tim McAvoy, the big junior, as they have rolled him onto the backboard, and we have to tell you, in all frankness, you've not really seen it, but Tim is not moved a whole lot, and that's not really a great situation. He has had some movement, nothing that he obviously wants to take a chance of, nor the medical personnel. And, you know, it's strange because we've been here for almost a day and a half now, and the stadium has been rocking and noisemakers and sounds, and there's not a whole lot going on right now. Bloomington, they say to themselves, you know, we see one of our guys down, we feel good about what's happening, but then we look over, and that's not great. Now, you see the Carmel Corsairs on the other side. Of course, they're trying to stay warm. Very cold day, very crisp day here. These two teams, I think, are going to have to do a little bit of stretching here by the time we resume in this game. You know, if we talk about the Carmel offense, but first let's take a look at the officials in this ball game. Is once again, they get down here by way of their ratings on the season. Rex Roberts, Christopher Hartbank, Jeffrey Collings, Howard Owens, and Mark Thomas. It is Howard Owens who is our head referee today. He's from Stillman Valley. And that's a kind of a nice town right now because they won, or check that, he is from Sullivan. I was going to say if it had been Stillman Valley, it would have been very nice because they won the Class 3A championship. You know, Jack, I want to talk about the option attack for Carmel. Andy Bitto has come on here, the head coach of the Carmel Corsairs. He is 54-19 in the 6 years at the helm. His first 2 years, though, just 8-11. And Andy said, I think I need to make a switch. I think I need to go to the option attack. And, you know, since then, it's worked out pretty well. 9-5, 11-2, 13-1, and 13-0.
Well, you know, it takes a while to get this system in place. And it doesn't just take one season where you take it to the varsity. You have to phase it through the program. And that was a situation which they did. They brought it in, but they also initiated at the lower levels with the freshmen and the sophomores. And this obviously, you know, brings it along slowly. And that's what took, you know, the first year or two for them to really grasp how intrinsic and difficult this particular option can be. But once they got a hold of it, you know, it's a continuance throughout the entire program. And he's done a great job. But the other thing that he did after his first couple of years, he brought in an old-timer named Bill Mack, who ran this system for years at Crystal Lake Central and at North Central College, and is a Hall of Fame coach and just a tremendous offensive mind. And he had him kind of help him along, wean him along with this offense. And Bill Mack is presently on the staff right now and has done a tremendous job of helping this entire program and this particular offense.
Well, and one other thing that Bitto did was he went and he studied some game films of some college teams. He really focused on Air Force and Georgia Southern, and we know what Air Force can do with their option attack.
Well, there is more versatility to this type of offense than is imaginable. Now, Air Force has run out of different formations, but it's basically the same plays out of different looks, which makes it a little more difficult for the defense to make sets and have reads for and that type of thing. And Andy obviously has done a tremendous coaching job here as long with his coaching staff.
We talk about the option attack for Bloomington. It is a different look. It is more of your classic option, whereas the Carmel option has been described by some as a shell game.
Well, what happens is it's more on the perimeter from outside the tackle. When you have an option which comes out of the eye as Bloomington, it's a little easier to key on. Now, you still can get the perimeter, but it's a little easier than what what Carmel's doing. You've got to keep those people. Backside pursuit cannot be flying to the football because they could be coming back at you. So it really freezes the back half of your defense with the type of offense that they run.
Tim McAvoy being wheeled off to the northeast corner of the stadium. There is a medical truck on site. Take a look at the numbers to this point with 3:56 to play in the first quarter. 116 yards, 71 of which came on the touchdown pass from Peden to Hughes. 32 pass yards, that'd be just about the distance of that touchdown pass to Jack Simmons. All tied up at 7, and we are ready to resume play. On second down.
Now there was a miscue.
Solon was looking for something that wasn't there.
I think he just went the wrong way on that. And if that's the only mistake he makes today.
I was going to say, here he is, what he's played, what, about 8 minutes in a state championship ball game. 1 week ago, exactly 1 week ago, he had no idea that this was going to happen. He's already generated a touchdown and thrown a touchdown pass, so he's all right.
Well, we tell players all the time is you're one play away from being a starter. You never know when it's going to happen.
Looking into the eyes of the junior. Mike Serio to the 30-yard line. 20 yards on the run for Serio. He carried for 7.4 yards per carry this year, 653 yards. He's known as a blocking back, the best blocking back that Bitto has ever had, and that time he has a first down.
Well-executed belly option. They fake to Popovich up the middle, which draws the linebackers inside, and then they give it to the second man off tackle. And it was very well executed.
Once again, Serio. Brought down inside the 10. Mike Serio for 21 yards before Rod Castillo tracked him down from his nose guard spot.
If it goes well the first time, run it the second time. You can see right there, he ran the fullback into what we call the A gap and then gave it to the back into the B gap. In other words, he drew the linebackers inside and the safety up, gave it to the second back, one gap over, big play.
They took it off the All-Stater off left tackle, Dan Osterhout, first down and goal for the Corsairs. Inside the 5-yard line.
They found
the carry
something
on the
they
play.
Like.
Steve Hieronymus, that time he assumed Serio's position on that right wing.
Third time in a row they've run that play the same direction. They found either a personnel matchup that they like, or a lot of times teams like to run to their bench or to a particular offensive lineman that's doing a good job on the man that's over him.
We talk about the fullback Popovich over 1,000 yards. You put Hieronymus and Serio together, they too have combined over 1,000 yards rushing. Solon, he's in.
Not bad for a kid 3 days ago that didn't even know he was going to play.
He has thrown for a touchdown pass. He has run for one, and Carmel, with 2 minutes left in the first quarter, has a 13-7 lead.
Now again, it's the same scenario. They fake to the fullback, fake to the running back, and he basically follows in that lead back, and it's basically a quarterback lead. Right here, he's just following him. They kick out, he goes underneath, touchdown. Real basic play out of a different look.
Miller's kick is blocked. Not a good elevation for Chris Miller, so we sit at a 6-point difference. We have played exactly 10 minutes in this 6A state championship ball game, and Carmel now on top 13-7. And you know, if you're looking at first quarter scoring, this is nothing unusual for the Corsairs. They score 134 points through their 13 games on the season. Bloomington also, they like to get off in a hurry. They have scored 173 in the first period through their 13 games this year.
Well, they better get on their horse here if they're going to do it with 2 minutes left. They better get rolling here. But they're certainly capable of it. They're a big play offense, both teams.
Yet it is a turnover that led to the 6-play, 56-yard drive that consumed 2 minutes and 9 seconds off this clock.
You cannot afford to give teams with these type of offenses that are so high-powered, you can't give them a short field. You've got to make them drive the length of the field. Hopefully they'll make a mistake, make a turnover. You can't give them half the field to work with.
Miller once again with the wind at his back on the kickoff. He's put two of them in the end zone. Hamron and Wade are deep for the Purple Raiders. the opportunity for a return. This is Wade.
Good open field tackle right there.
Tackle on the play by Tom Kloss, number 5 for Carmel. Return of 22 yards for Wade. Well, now time to send that offense back out there, an offense that in their first two possessions, the only time they were stopped is when they stopped themselves, when quarterback Jeremy Peden was able to drop the ball. Let's go down to Lee Hall very quickly on an update on Tim McAvoy. Lee?
All right, guys, thanks. I talked to Tim's dad. He said he hopes he's going to be all right. They're looking at his shoulder. They did have his head taped to the stretcher as they put him into the ambulance, so a very serious injury. We hope to have an update on his condition for you a little bit later.
All right, thank you very much. So I guess we just hold our breath between now and then. First time Wade has not had running room.
Well, they're running into the short side of the field, and you can use the sideline as another defender and have him turn it back in. You can see right here, they're kind of running the short side of the field. Carmel does a nice job of pursuing flat and not letting him get those shoulders turned up the field.
Second down and long. Quarterback is Jeremy Peden. Wade tries straight up the middle, and not much room there. Peeling himself off the pile is Jaron Rutledge, number 55 for Carmel. Rutledge, a defensive end.
And that was just a straight isolation right up the middle. And their cup of tea, bread and butter, is really to get on the perimeter with the option and spread and stretch the defense. Running up the middle is not going to be something they're going to do a lot of today.
First quarter clock winding down. Three touchdowns scored in this period. 7 yards for a first down, the Purple Raiders do. This is Hughes in motion. This is Hughes on the move. That's Brandon Hughes with the first down. You give him a head of steam, and you know, as fast as we saw Brandon Hughes on that 71-yard touchdown run, his coach Rigo Schmelzer says, you know, he's fast, but he's not as quick out of the blocks as some guys. But you get him started, and he will just accelerate, and that's what they did when they put him in motion.
Well, what they're doing there is they're getting him moving. It's like making a right turn on a red light. You're at zero, and the people coming along are already moving. This is the case here. The defense is in place. He's moving, so those linebackers have to start up. So that's a great play for short yarders like that.
That's the sixth first down of the day for Bloomington.
That was kind of an off-the-top-of-my-head analogy there.
I saw it. I saw the picture. Wade, we'll get back to the line, and that's it. That's a good news, bad news thing is Billy Maloney was there to put the stops to the senior speedster.
He had a couple of blockers out in front of him, and I think he just took his eye off the ball to look downfield there, and that can make the difference between hanging on to it and putting it on the ground.
Rigo Schmelzer will look up at the scoreboard that has reached 0-0-0 at the end of the first quarter. He will see his team down by 6 points in what has proven to be a very interesting Class 6A championship ball game. Carmel Corsairs leading Bloomington 13-7, a touchdown run, a touchdown pass from John Solon. Brandon Hughes with a long touchdown pass for the Purple Raiders. We'll step aside, get ready for the second quarter, but first, these words from your local station.
And welcome back to the University of Illinois. 13-7 is Carmel with the lead over Bloomington, and we are with Carmel Corsairs quarterback Mark Benegoni. Benegoni, a name well known in the Peoria area. His father and his uncle were both quarterbacks at Peoria Spalding. A tough break for you here, Mark.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a tough. Okay, he's got a pick, that's awesome. It's been a tough week. I broke my leg and I need surgery, so it's been a tough week, but I've been just trying to help John Solon out, a quarterback right now. He's doing a great job, and I mean, I'm just so proud of him right now. And hopefully, if we win, it doesn't matter, because that's what we've been working all year for as a team, and I'm all about the team, and it's a great feeling right now.
It's too bad you couldn't play down here. Your dad was a defensive back for the Illini back in the 70s.
Yeah, I was hoping to play here since December when we started lifting, but I mean, things work out. I mean, football, you get injuries, so I mean, it happens sometimes, but I'm just here to support the team and hopefully we get out a W here.
All right, Mark. Good luck to you, my friend.
Thank you, thanks a lot.
All right, Mark Venegoni injured but supporting his team down here on the sideline, back upstairs.
You know, and you saw his defensive team coming off the field, patting him on his shoulder. I don't even know if Mark realized that it was Jason Quasigro that picked off that pass, a second turnover in two possessions for Bloomington. And once again, the Corsairs playing with a short field. Jason Quasigro, what a great story he is. Quasigro was born with a club foot. He had multiple surgeries as a youngster, and now all he has is 4-5 speed, and he has put the Corsairs in great field position. Solon to Cirio. Slow developing play, and that thing is stacked up immediately inside. Mike Cirio had a couple of big gains earlier.
Well, something's a miss because on the very first handoff after the turnover, he fumbled it, and unfortunately they were able to repossess it. And again, on this one, this was not a real smooth flowing play.
Third down and long, and now the Corsairs from Carmel. That 6-point lead will be working against the wind early in the second quarter. Solon.
Got
for Quasigro. Jason Quasigro. He'll be short of the goal line, but what a grab by Quasigro. 25 yards, it will be first and goal.
Again, this is very much what we saw in the first quarter. A fake to the fullback, frees the DB, throws it up top, just on a streak route, and he goes up and gets it. Great play, great effort. And that's into a very strong wind. So he threw that long before the receiver broke.
Quasigro, 6'3" tall. The touchdown pass earlier went to Simmons, who stands 6'5". Solon straight up the middle. He's got his second touchdown of the day. Why not head up the middle of that offensive line? Some people consider the best offensive line in the state. Luke Krombach, Eddie Adamski, and Drew Cairo Gross, the guard, center, guard combination. Dan Osterhout, along with Paul Lyons, the right tackle, as Carmel says, with the missed extra point on the kick attempt, the last touchdown. We are going for two here.
Well, they hit that with the wind about 2 feet off the ground, so I don't think they would have done anything with this one. So this is a good call, and it's a no-brainer, excuse the term.
Popovich tried the middle. Nothing doing there, so we will set it a 19-7. Carmel lead just underneath, 2 minutes to play in the first half. Two turnovers, two quick touchdowns by Carmel. Miller now will have to hit this one short. Picked up by an up man.
Wow.
To the outside, this is Justin Harrison. Harrison run out of bounds by the kicker, Chris Miller, or he would have gone the distance as it is. 40 yards on the return for Harrison. Here are your numbers from the first quarter. We had 26 points put on the scoreboard. Even up in first downs, the rushing yardage tilts to the side of Bloomington. The big number right there, look at the two turnovers. That led to two Carmel scores.
And of course, those passing yards right there are two touchdowns. So it's really kind of a wide open game, but kind of different offenses.
Purple Raiders will start in Corsair territory. Way to the wide side of the field. Number 9, Matt Despain, slowed him down. He just eyeballed him all the way and finally got help from James Larson, the leading tackler this season for Carmel. If we talk about Larson, here's a guy, number 42, looking at him right there. He didn't play football until last season. And here he is leading this team in tackles. He also has 6 sacks topping the team.
Well, 6'2", 215 pounds. He runs well, and when he gets there, he's in a nasty mood. And Carmel's done a nice job of pursuing the football, especially in the perimeter plays.
Only 2 yards in that run for Wade. Harrison, the fullback, will nosedive his way inside the 30.
And I think that's exactly why they made that call, because Carmel was really getting the perimeters quickly, and they wanted to keep him honest by running Harrison up inside.
Billy Maloney, one of the quartet of linebackers for Carmel, with the tackle on that play. You take a look at Jeremy Peden running the offense. We mentioned that it was basically a quarterback battle for Bloomington prior to the season. Peden won it, and since then he has been outstanding. And Regal Schmelzer says, you know, this is the guy. He's one of the reasons we're here. He has exceeded, far exceeded our expectations of him. He took over, of course, from Andre Brown, three-year starter and all-stater for Bloomington last year. Peden with the pitch. Wade with some room. Brought down, and tell you what, it's like you're grabbing onto air right there because Wade can get by you in a hurry. Quasigrow with the tackle.
Well, what they did is they run motion the opposite way to get the secondary to rotate opposite, and they come up here and they got a one-on-one with the corner and a pretty good job of screening off by the wide receiver, and that was almost a big play right there. You can see they're walling everybody off, and he's got enough speed to get up in that seam, and some great pursuit right there stops a big play.
First down for the Raiders on the delay. First time we've seen that, and it may be the last.
Well, it's a sprint draw look, and you're going to do that if you've been throwing and dropping back, and they haven't been showing that type of action throughout the ball game, so it didn't really throw off the linebackers at all for Carmel.
Second down and long for the Purple Raiders. They work out of the eye. The lead man is Harrison. He has it, shakes through one tackle, through another, bangs through another. He's got a first and goal inside the five. Justin Harrison headed to this field right here next year. He is committed to the University of Illinois. That time, 14 yards to the first down.
Well, he is really a load. When he hits the hole, you can't bring him down with an arm tackle. You can see right here, he cuts back. It's just a block back. And look right here, he spins out, lowers his shoulder, got tremendous momentum up the field. And at 5'10", 205 pounds, he is a tough, tough running back.
Bloomington right back at you. Tries to pull a man into the end zone. Nothing doing. Larson again will just hang on, looking to get some help. But Harrison has nudged that ball closer. Justin Harrison, his coach considers him one of the premier players in Illinois that nobody really knows about. Now, he had center stage last year when Bloomington was here in the 6A finals, but he said he is by far the way the best athlete that Schmelzer has coached in his 22 years. He's got that ball a yard away from a score. And now he's in. Justin Harrison's 18th rushing touchdown of the season has pulled Bloomington to within six.
He hasn't come off the field yet, and he's exhausted, but he wants that football down there. And you can see right here, it's just a straight dive right in here, and he just blows in there. He wanted to get up off the ground, but he didn't have to. Kind of a read option, but they weren't reading anything. Harrison was getting the ball the whole way.
Peden, the extra point attempt is good. So now the difference is five. Two missed extra point opportunities for Carmel. Bloomington has come back, knocked both of theirs in, and we have ourselves an offensive shootout with 6:42 to play here in the first half. And why not? These two teams come in scoring 42 and 34 points, respectively, Carmel and Bloomington. And they haven't shown anything yet that would make you be disappointed in terms of their offensive production.
There's so many skilled kids out on that football field right now for both offenses, just a tremendous amount of skilled athletes. And when you put that kind of a combination on the field, it becomes very explosive, and there's a lot of points to be scored. It's difficult enough to make an open field tackle, but when you have kids that have this kind of agility, it's a tremendous feat.
Jack, you recall Bloomington's state basketball title there in 1910. Can you tell me a little bit about that one?
I think I was a sophomore.
Pretty good history there for the Purple Raiders. Most recent state title coming in boys tennis, 92.
My brother Jim would be excited about that. He's a tennis buff.
Back-to-back state titles in the early 90s for girls gymnastics team at Carmel. Those are your non-football state titles as Carmel, first trip down here. Bloomington, they're making it back-to-back journeys. On the return, Quasigrow hit hard. Now Carmel will have to play with a longer field than they've been accustomed to in their last two possessions. That last drive covered 37 yards and 7 plays, and it took 3 minutes and 27 seconds off the clock as Quasigrow brings this return back 18 yards. John Solon, quarterback for Carmel. I'd say so far so good. Two rushing touchdowns and a passing touchdown, and he's not yet reached the midway point of the second quarter. Fullback John Popovich has been somewhat quiet today, but he sets things up as he angles off the left side.
Just a little inside trap, and again, they're just trying to stop Bloomington from over pursuing, and by running the trap inside, that'll slow the linebackers down a little bit, and so they won't be able to get out on the edges too quickly.
Popovich, not a big fullback, 5'9", 180 pounds. He gets the tough yards. Most of his yards that he gets comes after that first hit. He got three on that carry.
Razzle dazzle.
Around the right side, and a big hit. Hieronymus is hammered by the animal, Justin Harrison, a pair of 22s meeting head on.
Well, there was some razzle by Carmel, but Bloomington wasn't dazzled too much. You can see the guard tackle pulling right out here, and it's just a reverse. Nice block right there, but Bloomington is not dazzled too much by the razzle.
Number 21, Donald Brown, was there as well, but it was Harrison stopped that made it a gain of maybe about 6 inches. Carmel 4-4 on third downs. They're faced with one here. They need 7 yards. Solon, a little wraparound. Popovich just lucky to come up with it.
Well, they didn't want to throw it into the wind. They'd rather run a draw here. But you can see where oftentimes their linebackers read draw before you get past, but he goes past the fullback and then wraps it around back into him.
Boy, what a good hop.
They were real lucky on that one.
We've already seen two turnovers today, both by Bloomington. They have led to a pair of touchdowns by the Carmel Corsairs.
This is going to be a tough punt right here. Better be like a knockdown five iron into the wind here.
Chris Miller, an All-State punter, averages 41 yards per kick. They closed on him in a hurry. That's a pretty good boot against this wind.
It is a good kick.
Be decent field position, though, for the Purple Raiders. You know, the one thing about Chris Miller, the punter, he averages 41 yards, and he's an All-State punter, but he hasn't gotten many opportunities to punt this year because Carmel has scored so often.
It's nice they have that kind of a situation.
Bloomington and Rigo Schmelzer, they know they're in this ball game, and they knew they would be. Last week against St. Rita, the final score was 20-7, the victory up in Chicago. However, many observers consider that closer than that game would indicate. Good field position from their own 44. Here comes Hughes. Does not go for as much as it did last time, just a shade over a yard as he gets across the 45.
Well, you have to realize that the Corsairs are going to be ready for this. They don't want him to get out in the open field. You can see right here he's coming in motion, and the defense rotates, but it's just a quick handoff to get him some speed on the edges, but Carmel doesn't fall for it. And they ran it once, but they know where their key players are, and those are the ones that they're really queuing in on, and obviously Hughes is a big factor that Carmel's going to be queuing in on.
It was number 33, Sean Murnane, that had Hughes in his sights. Harrison leaves that way. Let's see if Wade follows. He does. Harrison, big block for Hughes. But the big tackle is made near midfield. Once again, Matt Despain, number 9, is there.
Carmel's really done a nice job on the option. They've had people out on the perimeters, but they've closed it off real quickly because initially when it starts, it's a good read by the quarterback to pitch the ball because the perimeter is open. But the moment he pitches it, they close it down rather quickly, and they've done a great job of pursuing the football.
You know, it strikes me, if you're a Carmel fan watching at home, every time Wade or Hughes or Harrison touches the ball, you just take
it. Oh, absolutely. What do you think those coaches are doing down there? They're taking a big swallow every time they touch it, too. Those guys are big play threats.
They need 4 yards on third down. Peden. He's got the first down. Jeremy Peden, the 5'10 senior quarterback. He gives Bloomington the running dimension that Andre Brown the last 3 years didn't have. He makes good decisions. He knew where he had to get to, and that was a big play by the senior.
Well, that was a good scramble. Carmel kind of over pursued, and the backside rush threat came flat inside, and that opened up the outside, and he did a nice job of scrambling to pick up that first down.
Purple Raiders have now rushed for 181 yards on 24 carries. Tell you what, That's a lot of numbers with still 3 minutes to play here in the first half. They trail it, though, by five. Wade straight up the middle. Boy, look at his feet as he flies for another first down.
Well, the shortest distance between 2 points is right up the middle, straight at him, and that's what they're doing. And with the burst of speed that he has, that simple inside isolation play can develop into a big 40-yard touchdown run.
Patrick Kiminer, number 39 for Carmel in the brown jerseys. He was the one that finally stopped James Wade. 7.4-yard average per play now for the Purple Raiders. Carmel averaging 7.1 per play. Harrison, not much there.
Again, with a dynamic duo like Bloomington has with Harrison and Wade, you've got to keep the inside linebackers honest by running Harrison inside in order to get James Wade out on the perimeter.
Once again, Matt DeSpain came up from his safety position to be credited for the tackle. Get a good look at Harrison. As Jack said, he does not leave the field. He has not missed a play in the playoffs. He lines up in the fullback in front of Wade. Little trickery here. Hughes waits on a block. That's good coverage there by Carmel. That was a pretty good looking play when it first started out, but then Corsairs had a lot of brown jerseys in the vicinity. For Carmel, it was Jack Simmons. They made sure he stayed home to put the clamps on Hughes.
Again, before they just straight handoff. Now it's a counter, and he just intercepts the pitch, basically, is what he does, and he comes backside. But you've got to realize the preparation has been done for this game. Carmel has this team very well scouted. That's probably not the first time they've seen that play.
3 yards short of a first down here on third down. Wade's not going to get it there.
Four down territory there.
Sean Murnane, number 33, the first one up off the pile, 223-pound sophomore. And now Bloomington will take a timeout, their first, with 107 to play in this quarter, as Carmel has a man down at about the 20-yard line. Bloomington has already taken their timeout. 19-14, our score. That's the deficit that the Purple Raiders are looking to make up here in the final 67 seconds.
I've kind of got some, I'm going to share this with you for the first time, Dave. I've got a little history here with Carmel. I haven't told you this before.
Okay.
My brother Jim's three children attended Carmel High School. My oldest, my niece Regina, and my nephews Sean and Jamie both attended Carmel High School up in Mundelein. And so that's kind of how I got a feel for their athletic background over the years. Carmel's always had an excellent program, not only academically, but athletically. And obviously, the last several years, they've done extremely well in football. And obviously, this year, they're doing the best they've ever done. Just kind of a little sidelight there.
I very much enjoy that. And I'd like to inform everyone that my partner here, Jack McInerney, in the Illinois Coaches Hall of Fame on two occasions, as an inductee and also as a Ray Elliott Award winner. And how ironic that is that here we are, the home of Ray Elliott. Congratulations, my man.
Thank you very much, David. I appreciate that.
Now Bloomington will need 2 yards for a first down. They go for it on fourth down. Trailing by five late in the first half.
We got a problem here. The fullback was supposed to go in motion here. You saw the quarterback move his foot, which is the indicator. And he looked out to the flanker, and the flanker said, no, not me. And it was supposed to be the fullback going in motion.
Oh, and then you probably caught a glimpse there of Peden showing Harrison, yes, I was picking my foot up. Wade, James Wade, the tailback, said, yeah, he was doing the same thing. He was picking his foot up. And now all of a sudden, the fourth and two becomes fourth and seven. Well, that's a huge, that is, you know, it'll go 5 yards in the stats, but that is a huge penalty.
Well, this could come back and haunt you later on when you start recapping plays. You might forget about this if the score is different, but right here and now, that is a big, big play.
See, four receivers will go out on this pattern. Wade, the only man in the backfield on fourth and seven. Peden by himself. Intercepted at the 5 yard line. It may have been better that they had just dropped it. However, it's Sean Murnane, the defensive end, that dropped off. The sophomore defensive end picks it off at the 5 yard line. That's the third Bloomington turnover here in the first half.
Well, Jeremy Payton gets scrambled here and is flushed out of the pocket, and he tries to make something happen. And obviously the ball gets deflected, and it's a smart move to go down. You know, it's nothing worse than a punt, except they had fourth and one and an opportunity to go in and score here, because they certainly had plenty of time. And right now, Carmel's just going to try and punch it out, get it out to midfield without a turnover down here and go into halftime, 19-14.
Bloomington with now three turnovers in their five possessions. The two times they've not turned it over, they've scored. It'll be a gain of about 6 yards as we cross the 10. Popovich on the carry. So again, John Popovich on the day. That's his seventh rush of the day.
So all they want to do is let that clock run, get it down to about 5 seconds on the play clock, and then run the play, and again, probably beat a Popovich fullback dive. We don't want any turnovers down here.
Bloomington figures they're due to force one defensively, having given up three of their own.
Right now they're emotionally deflated after that.
Yes, they are.
Fourth and one turning into a fourth and six.
Solon will just take the knee to run this clock out, and Purple Raiders have no reason on their own to stop it, so we will wind down the first half of play. Carmel leading 19-14. The story here, the turnovers, three turnovers for Bloomington, plus the penalty on fourth down and two, have hurt them mightily. The two of the three turnovers resulted in touchdowns by Carmel. The other time that Bloomington has had it without turning the ball over or getting a penalty, they've been able to take it in for their scores. High scoring affair, 33 points in the first half, over 200 yards rushing for Bloomington, and all they show is a 5-point deficit on the scoreboard.
Well, you know, this is one of those on your toes type of teams for both of them. We know that either one of them can score at any time.
Man that's had a lot of points scored for him this year is standing by with Lee Hall. Lee?
All right, guys, we're with Carmel, Coach Bitto, and Coach, a big stop there by your defense there to end the quarter.
Yeah, we got lucky. We had three turnovers in the first half that kind of kept us in the game. We got to play a better job, do a better job on special teams and our field goal extra point team, and we should be okay.
You took advantage of a couple of Bloomington turnovers and got points off of that.
Yeah, our defense did a nice job getting us short fields. We got a new quarterback. Our starting quarterback got hurt, and that really kind of boosts his confidence. I think he's playing real well. If we can hold on to the football and control the clock like we did in the first quarter and middle of the second quarter, we should be all right. We got to stop the big play, though.
All right, Coach, good luck second half.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
All right, back upstairs to you, Dave.
Two undefeated teams, two teams looking for their first football state championship. We've played a half here at Memorial Stadium in Champaign in the Class 6A championship ball game. And right now, it's Carmel and Mundelein on top of Bloomington, 19-14.
And we are back at Memorial Stadium in Champaign. Carmel of Mundelein leading Bloomington 19-14 at the half. Hi, I'm Lee Hall, and I'm here with the obligatory cheerleader interviews. Yay! That's the Carmel Corsairs, and we understand the Corsair is another name for Catholic pirate. Is that right?
So.
So this is Kimmy. She's going to act as spokesperson. What's the hardest part about being a cheerleader?
Keeping your spirit up, not staying warm, one of the hardest things, and making sure the fans know that you know what's going on.
You guys cheer for another sport, but you're a bit of a sport yourself, aren't you?
We are
sort
a sport.
Of.
No, we are. Oh. We're a sport.
Ooh, I think I touched a nerve there, didn't I?
Yeah, we cheer for basketball, and then we're gonna compete later in the year. We also go to state and we go to nationals and stuff too, so it's pretty exciting. We're looking for support from the team too.
That's what I'm talking about. Gee whiz, you're like my wife and my daughter at home, man. You give me a hard time. Hey, great girls basketball team at Carmel too, right?
Yeah, 12, yeah, woo!
All right, well, let's hear this cheer you're gonna do for us now, all right? Is it tough to find things to match with brown and yellow?
Sometimes.
I'm just kidding. Go ahead. I'm taking your time. Go on.
Yeah.
All right. All right. Go Catholic Pirates. All right. And now let's go to the Bloomington Purple Raiders. I see I have a soft spot in my heart for Bloomington because you have the purple and gold, and that was what my high school colors were. So I like the outfits. Tell me about Bloomington cheerleading. Tell me all about it.
Well, we're doing really good this year, and our coaches, we have new coaches, and they're excellent, and we're going to come back, and we're going to win this.
Do you guys get to go to Chicago next weekend with a basketball team? Oh, last weekend for football. Did you like Chicago? Did you get to go to Chicago?
Yeah, we did. It was a lot of fun.
A lot of fun. You guys played well up there, huh?
Oh, yeah, we did. It was an awesome game.
All right, you guys got a cheer for me? All right, well, let's hear it. Purple Raiders. And of course, a Purple Raider is a non-denominational pirate, of course. So congratulations, good luck to you girls later, all right? All right, we'll be back with more from Memorial Stadium after these local messages. And we are back at Memorial Stadium in Champaign, Illinois, 19-14, our halftime score. We are with Jim Flynn of the Illinois High School Association, soon to be the retired Jim Flynn. I bet you're looking forward to that.
Well, we've got three more championship games of football today to get through, and then we've got all of basketball and the winter sports and then spring. And then once the spring sports are over, then I can really look forward to that last day.
How many years with the IHSA?
31 and a half when I retire, Lee.
31 and a half. So many championships, so many kids. Anything stick out in your mind from those years?
I think the one thing that's really impressive was when we moved the basketball tournament from Champaign to Peoria. That was a big deal around the state. And the people of Peoria have really made the basketball tournament a success. And because of that, I think the people in Champaign, now that we have the football championship games here, have made our football games are really a showcase event that we've got probably one of the best football championship game concepts in the entire United States. And so the people in Champaign-Urbana need to be proud of that.
What have they done to actually make the, I mean, it has really, I mean, people thought, well, you bring it to Champaign, there's going to be a lot of empty stands, blah, blah, blah. It's too big a facility for high school football, but it's been fantastic.
Oh, it's a great facility. The kids love it who are when they play the games. The new turf has made it a great. Today's games, for example, we're playing on wonderful turf after yesterday we had the snow here on the field, and even yesterday when we had the snow on the field, there was no problem with the traction of the athletes in that. The stadium is an atmosphere that everyone remembers, and that's part of the high school experience when you're participating in our championship games. And then the Chamber of Commerce works with us. They have what they call a tent city, and every team that plays in the championship game has their own tent where they can hold their pregame pep rallies and their postgame celebrations or talk about the second place team or whatever. And it's just a great, wonderful atmosphere.
How much has the IHSA's role changed in 31 and a half years? Well, 31 years, it's not the half yet.
I think what really has changed is when I started, our responsibility was to conduct interscholastic state series competitions and be the governing body for the interscholastic program, and now we're into character building and citizenship, and in some instances participation in interscholastic athletics is like being an extension of the family, and those who are involved in the interscholastic program as coaches and administrators are family, or at least the extended family, for many students who otherwise don't have that nurturing.
You want to say hi to the granddaughters?
I'd like to say hi to the fabulous Flynn twins, Keely and Casey, and Grandpa will be home later.
All right, Jim, always a pleasure. All right, and now we've got one of the bravest guys in the building here, wearing his Purdue hat, Billy Dickin, former Bloomington High School star, former Purdue Boilermaker star, now playing indoor football. Tell me about being back down here and watching your school play for another state championship. It's been 12 years since you were here. I can't believe it. We covered that game, and you were a player.
Yeah, it's been a while, you know, and it's just great to see Bloomington back in the state championship. You know, we've been a pretty good program, you know, over the years, but, you know, we need to beat these, you know, Chicago teams, you know, to really prove ourselves. And, you know, hopefully this the third time's a charm here, and, you know, hope the Raiders pull it out.
What do you remember about your experience in the state championship game?
Well, you know, when I was playing, it was, you know, in ISU, you know, and it was a great experience because it was like a hometown, you know, thing, and it was a packed stadium, and it was a great experience. You know, unfortunately, we lost the game, but it was still, you know, an unforgettable experience.
Tell me about your career now. You went on and played at Purdue and had a very successful career there, and now playing some arena ball inside out of this cold. I like that idea.
Yeah, you know, no wind, you know, 72 degrees, perfect for a quarterback. So, you know, I don't have to worry about throwing the ball. I don't have to worry about if it's raining, snow, and wind. But, you know, it's fun. It's fun to still be, you know, throwing the football around, you know, 10 years out of high school or 12 years out of high school. So, you know, I'm just having a great time. And, you know, hopefully my body will stay healthy enough that I can continue to play.
I know you're doing some coaching at Illinois Wesleyan over in Bloomington, too. What kind of things would you suggest if you were in the locker room with Rego Schmelzer right now?
I don't know, you know, give the ball to Harrison, I guess, you know. I mean, the guy's an amazing athlete, and, you know, Illinois is getting a great football player in Justin. And, you know, just pound it with Harrison and Wade, and don't turn over the football. You know, I think the turnovers have really hurt Bloomington today. So I think we'll be okay. You know, we're still in the game. It's only, you know, what is it, a five-point game. So, you know, Bloomington could still win this one.
All right, Billy, always a pleasure.
Thanks,
sir. All right, Billy Dickin, former Bloomington High School star, just a great example of what kids can go on and do after their high school careers. Back with more from Memorial Stadium after these messages from your local stations.
Look at the fans that are settling in to get ready for this second half. 19-14 is your halftime score. Carmel of Mundelein on top of the Bloomington Purple Raiders. We welcome you back. I'm Dave Bernard, along with Jack McInerney, in what has proven to be a very entertaining first half. And, you know, Jack, I don't think we expected anything different. I mean, I think we came here today and we said, you know, with the speed of Bloomington, we talked about it earlier, the deception of Carmel, this could be fun.
Well, there really is, and there is a lot more firepower, folks, yet to come in this second half. Both these teams have tremendous skilled kids with a lot of speed. They've been averaging almost 40 points per game for each team. There's a lot of light bulbs yet still to be burned out in the second half, so stick around.
Let's take a look at those first half numbers that have been rolling up here as you take a look. Now, the rushing yardage, that 201 yards, they have officially given Brandon Hughes 71 yards on that touchdown as a rush and not as a pass. So that 71 yards is part of that, those rushing figures. So those are some pretty hefty numbers.
Well, they are big numbers as far as Carmel being able to stop them. But the other part of that is, look at the versatility of Carmel's numbers on the rush and the pass. And of course, two passes, one a touchdown and one leading up to a touchdown. So that versatility has kept Bloomington on their heels, more or less.
John Solon, in fact, the quarterback, was not a great passer compared to Mark Venegoni, who is out. However, you know what? 2 for 2 for 59 yards, one a touchdown and one putting it inside the 5-yard line. Obviously, Solon has done his job.
Well, what that does is it keeps the defensive backs off the line of scrimmage, which leads to that running game. It doesn't seem like a lot. You look at it and you say, well, two passes, big deal. But for high school secondary kids, that keeps them off. They don't want something thrown over their heads. And obviously, then that leads to the running game being to be more effective for Carmel.
Other interesting numbers on that last page, 4 of 5 in third down conversions. That's what both teams have done. But they've been able to strike quickly as we take a look back at some of the highlights here in the first half. And, well, you didn't get a chance to settle down too quickly, and that's when Brandon Hughes took this short little, what turned out to be a run.
Well, Brandon Hughes has been averaging 32 yards per catch, and here's the great track speed that he has, and he just takes off down the sideline, and you couldn't catch him on a 707.
Of course, Carmel, they got their hands on the ball. They came right back. Here is your backup quarterback, Solon.
There it is, the play-action pass to hold the secondary. That's all he needs, and he gets up to the 6'5 receiver, and that's where the mismatch occurs.
Jack Simmons with that touchdown reception. The next time after a turnover, Solon said, I'm going to take it in from a yard out. That settled, that capped it off after Quasigro with the pass. And here is Solon again. He's done the job.
Just following that running back in, big offensive line. Here's the option right here. Give it to the fullback. He does his dive. Harrison's got his touchdown from 2 yards out.
Well, Justin Harrison capped off that particular drive. The only time that Bloomington has been stopped today, quite frankly, is the turnovers. And as Lee asked Billy Dickin just moments ago, you know, what do you do if you're Rego Schmelzer? Well, the only thing you could do if you're Rego is say, you know, let's hang on to the ball, let's not give it to him, because if Bloomington doesn't give it back, they score.
Well, you know, it's a lump in your throat every time one of these teams gets the ball, because they're so explosive that you don't know when they can score and where they can score from. It's not as if field position, I mean, that's a factor, obviously, you want to give them a longer field work with, but they're so explosive that they can score on any given play, and that's what makes this game so dangerous. I mean, you are tense, I'm tense, you never are, I'm always tense.
As far as Mark Venegoni is concerned, he is the All-State quarterback from Carmel. He had a great 2-year career. injured last week. He broke his ankles. You heard him talk to Lee. A broken leg surgery. But you know what? I something that it looks like it's appeared with the Corsairs. They have rallied behind the entire situation, John Solon in particular, but I think it's almost been a way to bring this team tighter together than they were before.
There's no doubt about that, and I think a big factor is the coaching staff. You know, they've developed so much confidence in these kids, and then they in turn have developed confidence amongst themselves. There's tremendous chemistry down there with the Corsairs, and they've just rallied around this young quarterback. You know, what kind of a scenario could this possibly be? It's a Cinderella story. 13-0 state championship, the star gets hurt, and here comes this junior coming in. He's thrown for one, scored two. This is a great situation.
Eight classes of football are played here on two consecutive days over Thanksgiving weekend, and anytime you come down to Champaign, you know the weather could be a variety of things. Here is yesterday. This is what it looked like yesterday. This is Iroquois West in Carthage. That's actually when the field looked good. We had snow. It was very cold and very windy yesterday. Here it is today. A different day. Don't be fooled, though. It's still quite brisk. Temperature in the low 30s. I think game time temperature in the 5A game was about 23 degrees with a wind chill of 12. However, the playing surface here, the Astro Play surface, certainly not a factor, and certainly a key if you're Bloomington, that you kind of like the way that this track is playing out. This plays right into what you can do.
Well, absolutely. For both teams, this is a great surface to play on. One of the reasons that they did move down here, and you know, you don't want to bring that up, but you can't play nowadays on a, if teams have been playing all for games and weeks and months on top of fields that are not in good condition. You're playing the biggest game of the year. You want it to be in great conditions, and this certainly is one of the finest fields in the Midwest.
The biggest two quarters of the year coming up next for these two teams. Carmel of Mundelein and the Purple Raiders from Bloomington. And right now it's Carmel 19-14 over Bloomington as we get set for the second half as we step aside for these local messages.
And we're back at Memorial Stadium, 19-14, our halftime score, and the Corsairs enjoying a five-point lead here at the half, and we're with some of the fans who are enjoying today's action, Emily Perrineau, Aaron Kane, and friends from Carmel. When did you guys come down?
This morning.
You came down today, okay. Tell me about this football game so far, Aaron.
I don't know, it's a lot of fun. It's really close. It's really scary, but we'll win.
You got it. You heard it there first from Aaron. Emily is a pitcher. She's a softball pitcher. I'm guessing you'd like to see this many fans out for a softball game next spring, wouldn't you?
Oh yeah. We don't get too many of them.
That's going to be our quest today. We want you all to come out to the softball games next year. See? All you got to do is ask. Give us a quick scouting report on Carmel softball. Are we going to see you at State in East Peoria?
Oh, I hope so. I really hope so.
It's all on your back, Emily. It's all about the pitcher in softball. You know that.
Yeah, it's a good responsibility, and I'm fully ready for it.
All right, go Corsairs, right? Is that what you guys say?
Oh, very much so.
Equal time for Bloomington, of course. Hey, good luck to you. Have fun, all right? All right, some of the Carmel fans enjoying today's action. Back upstairs to you, Dave.
Thank you very much, Lee. And, you know, we like to talk in the pregame about keys to the ball game, and, you know, we get all psyched up, we're ready to go, and then that kickoff starts, and a lot of times we forget, what were those keys? Well, you don't have that opportunity here to forget them because we bring them back. Jack, how's it shaping up?
Well, so far both teams have played pretty good defense, so the misdirection time that they prepared for was well spent as far as Bloomington's concerned. They're taking advantage of the turf and obviously attacked a new quarterback. They haven't done it yet.
On the other side for Carmel, you know, they, oh my goodness. Forget about what you see in the background. Concentrate on the keys in the foreground.
Well, at this point, that loss has not been that great, as has been shown in the first half. Confidence is low, obviously they have shown that, and he and himself, and of course speed kills. That's still going to be something that we're going to continue to watch throughout the second half.
Rigo Schmelzer standing by with Lee Hall.
All right, Dave, thanks a lot. Coach, what did you tell your team there at halftime?
I think we've done a poor job on the defensive side, things that we feel like we know what's coming at us, we just haven't defended it well. On the offensive side, we've had some mental breakdowns also. We'll find ourselves in the ball game, only five down. We just need to execute better. We know we're up against, obviously, a quality program. I think right now we feel, though, that we should have another score up there. We can get something this third period. I think we can make a ball game out of it.
All right, Coach, good luck to you second half.
Thank you.
All right, Rigo Schmelzer, the Bloomington Purple Raiders. Back upstairs to you, Dave.
We saw that record, 105-22 in 11 years for Rigo, but how about this? The last 4 years, the Purple Raiders, 47-3 under Rigo Schmelzer. You know, when you take a look, well, Billy Dickens said, you know, we didn't win it when we lost Providence, and last year Rigo Schmelzer didn't win it when they lost to Mount Carmel. But you take it away, you go 47-3 in 4 years, you're getting the job done.
Well, you're not only getting the job done, but you're not nervous about being down by four at halftime. Mm-hmm. You've been there, you've been through it, you have confidence in your program, in your players, and the whole system. So at this point, you know, I mean, it's a factor on the board, and it's probably a factor for the fans, but for the coaches and the kids, it's an even ball game.
Last week in St. Rita, Bloomington, at times, and Rigo admitted it, he said, you know, we did get worn down a little bit in the second half by the bigger St. Rita team. Now, it's a bigger Carmel team here today, and we still have two quarters to play. Have you seen any indication at all that the smaller defensive unit could get worn down by the big offense?
Well, the only thing I've seen is that Justin Harrison a couple times looked like he was getting a little drained of energy. You know, he's been on the field the whole time. He's been a blocker. He's been a ball carrier, and he's been a tackler. That stuff drains you. He's around the ball all the time. It's not like he can take a break by being a defensive back where the ball's away or he's a safety. He's involved in almost every single play, and I think that could be a slight factor going in the second half. But you know what? He's got a long time to rest, so I don't foresee him giving up too easily.
Bloomington will kick off. They will have the wind at their back here in the third quarter. And as we see the flags atop Memorial Stadium, not enough to disrupt the ball on the tee as we did see a few times yesterday in the Class 1A through 4A ball games. But nevertheless, the wind to the back of the Raiders as Quasigro deep for Carmel. They will kick it away to him, Sirio, Mike Sirio, to take it at the five. And Carmel will start after the tackle made by Tanner Patches, number two. Carmel will start just outside their 20. Mike Sirio, that young man right there, he was, well, I don't know how close Andy Biddle was in terms of making that final decision. He was that close to being the quarterback today, but Andy said, you know, the competition that really brought out a spirited week of practices up in Mundelein. He went with his junior quarterback, his backup quarterback, John Solon, and I'd have to say it's worked out pretty well. He's got a 5-point lead as we start the third quarter.
That would certainly not be a move that I would second guess at this stage.
We may have some motion here. It was a long count by Solon.
Could be a delay. Motion.
5-yard penalty starts the third quarter. If you're looking at penalties in the ball game, that's the first penalty on Carmel. Bloomington had a 5-yard penalty.
False start, offense. 5 yards, still first down.
That 5-yard penalty by Bloomington took it away from a 4th-and-2.
There's a shot out of the left there of Bill Mack, Hall of Fame coach, and one of the coaches that came along here to institute this offense here at Carmel.
They'll start with the fullback up the middle. That is John Popovich, the 5'9", 180-pound senior. He gets that penalty yardage back.
Well, he's been a hard-nosed fullback all year long for them. He makes everybody else look good because he does all the tough work inside between the tackles. And when you can gain over 1,000 yards as a fullback, you have done some dirty work because you are really in the trenches when you're pounding up inside. Well, Harrison's done the same thing for Bloomington.
Both of those fullbacks over 1,000 yards on the season. Second and 10. Once again, they try the middle of that defensive unit. Right up the middle on Eric Miller, Rod Castillo, and Matt Logsdon. And that time it was the linebacker cleaning up. Dane Ramirez, the second leading tackler for Bloomington. He wears number 48, 5'11 senior. Long third down here, 3rd-and-8. We've seen Solon throw against the wind. He brings Quasigro into the game with him as he runs the play in from the huddle or from the sidelines. Quasigro had a big catch in the first half. He will head to the top of your screen. Jack Simmons is the other big target down to the bottom. Quasigro with a pitch. Not much doing. Good coverage on the play by Bloomington from all angles. Adrian Arrington with the tackle. He also got help from Ramirez.
Actually, that play was a well-called play. Had that defensive lineman not made that play with penetration in the backfield, that play would have gone a long way. What it did was throw off the timing and allow the defensive back to recover and get to the pursuit angles, because that was going to be a big play.
Donald Brown is deep for the Raiders.
Nice,
Miller hits
nice
a beauty.
Kick.
Wow.
Brown puts the knee down. That is a great kick against the wind for Chris Miller. 41 yards, that's his season average against about a 15-mile-an-hour wind.
You folks at home, you can't appreciate what a tremendous kick that was, because the wind is really blowing. He got it up high in the air, which really enhanced its value of being knocked down by that wind, but it certainly didn't do that. That was a tremendous kick.
Now the Carmel defense will come on the field as Miller will exit. Jeremy Peden, number four, the quarterback, will lead his unit on. Two touchdowns today for the Purple Raiders. Wade finds an opening to the outside. A first down near the 45-yard line. Jack Simmons had to come up to make that stop, and he grabbed him by the shoulder pads, but not before Wade had 15.
Well, James Wade is not a big back, and here's Harrison leading it. He just dips inside, and then he gets right outside. And with that tremendous speed, he's had an 89-yard touchdown run this year. He can go any snap, he's gone.
There have been some good tackling by the members of the secondary for Carmel today on plays just like that on the edges.
And they better be, because those have been gone.
Harrison in motion. Peden on first down. Brandon Hughes, his second touchdown of the day, and Bloomington has retaken the lead at 20-19.
Well, it's a combination of the earlier plays with the play action fakes here coming in, and Hughes with that tremendous speed just gets outside and he rolls a little bit, and it's really a throwback because he's coming from the other side and he got in behind the DB. He actually got right in behind Jack Simmons, and it was a great throw. Great throw, right on the money.
Hughes fingertip catch. Peden for the 21st point for Bloomington. No. We've had three missed extra points in this ball game. It's a one-point lead for the Purple Raiders.
And as we said at halftime, they can score at any time.
20-19 early, third quarter. This is the 6A state championship game from Champaign.
Okay, here's the matchup we're looking for down at the bottom. We have the fastest man on Bloomington's team, Brandon Hughes, and he's just running a go route against Jack Simmons, their best defensive player, and he beats him by 5 yards. That's speed against speed, but a perfectly thrown pass, folks, but let me add, with the wind. That was the big factor there. That was Brandon Hughes over the top, Jack Simmons getting beat.
The 11th touchdown grab on the season for Hughes, the 18th pass thrown for a score. For Peden, Quasigrove. And now Carmel, the ball, 9-10 left, third quarter. They trail it for the second time today. The last time they trailed, all they did was come right down and match Bloomington's score, and that's how we opened up the scoring today. There is your scoring drive. Doesn't take long, does it? Now when you have the speedster, that 53-yard touchdown pass, 68 yards in a couple of plays. Remember, it was Wade's 15-yard run that got it started. Solon with the keep. You know, the one thing you look at the option, Carmel does not mind running or playing with their dark brown jerseys. Why? Because with the ball fakes, that ball just gets hidden right in there under the numbers.
That's right. It certainly does. I'm surprised you caught on to those kind of coaching tricks so quickly.
That's a trick. I mean, would they change their school colors just to run the option?
Hey, you never know sometimes what coaches will do.
Short gain for Solon. Tumbled down at the line is John Popovich. May have been Matt Loggs, the number 74, that got a hand in there. Loggs and the biggest member of that front four. Logson stands 5'10", and he puts it at 258 pounds on that frame.
I'll tell you what, the Bloomington linebackers are really doing a nice job. You can see right there that Carmel's concerned about taking that ball home.
They've taken it to the end zone three times today.
Low budget, I guess, up in Mundelein.
Third down and seven. Solon to Simmons. Simmons will have the first down. A big guy is able to run through the tackle of Donald Brown.
I'm really impressed with Solon. That was a good throw against the wind. Only needed sevens, just a curl route. He just takes a three-step drop, one, two, three, throw the ball. He's curled up right here, makes a nice cut to the outside and picks up the first down. Well-executed play against a very strong wind.
You mentioned it while you were reviewing the keys just at the close of halftime that not only do the teammates look like they have confidence in Solon, but John Solon, I think, really believes in himself here today. Some movement, it will net a couple of yards, but a little bit of deception there as Popovich ends up with the carry.
You know, the surrounding cast can always make you look good. Now, you look down on the field, and, you know, Carmel's 13-0. They've got a great offensive line, outstanding running backs around them. So that surrounding cast can make him look good. I mean, that's just the way it is, like you have done for me for years.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Once again, a short gain on first down. Leaves a second and long. Popovich, the fullback, to the 40. John Popovich looking for a block. He gets it inside the 15.
Wow.
We've been waiting for that all day. Popovich has done that all year. This time he busts it for 46 yards.
And you know, that's just an inside trap right up the gut. You can see right here, he just pops it and just does a nice job of running. And what he gets is a great effort downfield by his receiver right there, making that big block. Jack Simmons continues to work. The whistle didn't blow. He's downfield. And here's Popovich showing us a little speed. But right here is a great effort by Simmons right there. That's a great block. And it takes it 10 yards further down.
Into scoring territory. Not much up the middle. You know, and that's one thing that Carmel coaches. You block, you block, you block. You play the play all the way out. And as you said, here's Simmons, a guy that's headed to University of Minnesota. He's 40 yards downfield leading the way for you.
Well, you know, oftentimes people say, well, how does he know to throw the block? Because the whistle hasn't blown. So you keep blocking until you hear that whistle blown.
Just outside the 10-yard line, looking to take the lead. Solon. John Solon stretches. He's in. Great strength from the junior, John Solon, with his third touchdown of the day, and the Carmel Corsairs have answered. They retake the lead, 25-20.
Can the fairy tale of Cinderella ever be retold into the John Solon story? He is really, really making them look good. For the whole week, everybody's been saying, well, Carmel just won't be the same.
Right.
Well, I'll tell you what, I can't imagine what they must be like. Otherwise, he's doing a great job.
Key two-point conversion attempt here. Throwing for it. Simmons will not be able to come away with it. Brandon Hughes on the coverage, so we sit at a five-point difference. What was a five-point halftime deficit for Bloomington, 19.3 and a half, has now changed 25-20, Carmel lead.
We'll get a good shot of Solon right here. And what he's going to do, he's going to fake to the fullback coming right up inside. And then he's going to follow him in the next gap as this closes down. See the linebacker close down on the fullback? And here he comes right up in through here. And that's all that play is designed to do, is to get that linebacker close on the fullback. And then when that happens, you pull it out and you go the next gap over. It always looks so much easier up here.
It does. But of course, now you're talking about a man that has to make those reads. Chris Miller, now the first time that he will be kicking off against the wind. Well, actually, the second time. He did have an opportunity in the second quarter.
This is going to be a squib kick. He's not going to try and get it up in the air. He's going to try and punch it through there, allow his people to get down there. Nice low line drive. That's a heck of a kick.
Wade inside the 10. Bloomington, with 6:04 to play in the third quarter, will look to answer. This IHSA broadcast is brought to you by Country Insurance and Financial Services. Real people, real answers, real quick. And by Chevrolet and your local Chevrolet dealers. Chevrolet, an official sponsor of the Illinois High School Football Championships.
Personally, I would have had my kicker make sure I'm kicking it away from Wade. I don't want him to handle the ball in the open field.
He's handling it now in the backfield. He'll get a couple of yards, but nice stay-at-home play that time for Carmel. Jim Magna, one of the linebackers, 6'1 senior, said, not in my neck of the woods.
They've really got a good group of linebackers there. Magnum, Keimner, Larson, Maloney. They're very, very active and very physical.
Jeremy Peden takes his time at the line. The option pitch. Wade!
Bye-bye!
James Wade!
Now,
not gonna get there.
You know what happened there? Brandon Hughes, the fastest guy on the team, was leading him down the field. He turned and looked the wrong way, and he missed the block. That should have been a touchdown.
Watch number 20, James Luby, close the gap.
This elite option, he comes right up inside here. Now, as we get further down the field, watch for number 17, right there. Now, he does not, he's got a man there. He turns away, and when he turns away, that's exactly when Jim Luby came in and made the big tackle right there. That play should have been six.
61-yard run for James Wade. He's up to 140 yards now, and here come the Purple Raiders. Harrison, the fullback, for about six.
It's such a critical play. A lot of people think, well, you know, it's third down. That's such a big play. First down is so crucial. Here's first down. He gets 6 yards. Now you got, you know, you've got three downs to make to pick up that touchdown of the first down. And when you have a fullback like that inside, man, that's such a luxury.
Justin Harrison headed to the University of Illinois, playing his college football on this turf. Sets up the second down and four. Bloomington now looking for the go-ahead score. He gets it again. He's inside the five. It will be first and goal, Raiders.
You know, wow. An athlete of his ability makes you wonder, where's Illinois going to play him?
Right.
I mean, what's nice about recruiting a kid like that is you have choices. He could be a running back or a fullback type, or he could be a linebacker.
5'10", 205 pounds. Great athlete. And it's first and goal for the Raiders. They trail it 25-20 as we go back and forth in the 6A championship. He gets it again. He'll get a yard when he should have been stopped for no gain. Off the pile, number 33, Sean Murnane, along with number 42, James Larson. Billy Maloney, number 53 as well. We cut the distance in half.
Down here is where the term I use, linemen score. And the reason I say that is because it's a shortened field and everybody's in the trenches, and the backs really don't score the touchdowns here, the linemen do.
Miller, Higby, Kelch, Hennenberg, and Petty, the men up front for the Raiders. Wade. Nothing yet.
Oh, they're saying he's lost the ball, and somebody's saying he's down.
The men in the striped shirts, the ones that make the decision. It will stay with the Purple Raiders that far away from a score. Let's take a look.
Well, this is an isolation right here. They're just leading up with the lead blocker being Harrison, and it looks like, you know, you don't want to second guess, but kind of from here. And, of course, we have a bad angle. Those guys have the best angle. There's two. They're right on the line of scrimmage.
Third and goal. Harrison. Touchdown. Bloomington the lead. Justin Harrison, second score of the day. It is now Bloomington 26, Carmel 25. This one could go this way for another quarter and a half.
I feel like I'm sitting at mid-court at Wimbledon, just the ball going back and forth across the net from either side, like watching a tennis match.
Boy, the character of these two teams. Bloomington scored to start the second half. Carmel came back, and here come the Purple Raiders once again, answering the one-point lead, and they, of course, will go for two. Peden to throw.
Wide open.
Did not get the elevation.
Great play.
Jim Magna, number 21, he was the man that got those hands up in the air.
Harrison was wide open in the end zone. Harrison is one of their top receivers coming out of the backfield, and he was wide open in the flat. Had he not gotten his hands up, 2 points.
Oh, you take a look at the way this game has played out. A couple of missed extra point conversions early by Carmel, and has set up our little two-point game we've been playing. Now Bloomington missed one earlier, so we sit at this one-point difference. 2:40 left in the third quarter.
These are two of the larger crowds I've seen down here.
Boy, Carmel, that's a long trip from Mundelein, and they have packed it in. They were winners of the East Suburban Catholic Conference as we take a look here through Memorial Stadium as they do stretch up underneath the upper deck here. Of course, Harrison Carmel, the East Suburban Catholic Conference champions, the team that finished second. Well, they are your current 5A state champions. That's the Joliet Catholic Academy Hilltoppers. Those two teams met in the final game of the regular season. Carmel, a 41-14 winner over Joliet Catholic in that one. Serio had to look up into the sun. He's got room. Mike Serio. One man
to beat. He's gone. He's gone. Here's our tennis match.
How about that? Carmel goes on top. About a 90-yard kickoff return. We'll call it 95. The Corsairs lead at 31-26.
That is truly amazing. Now, Carmel has had two other kickoffs where they came close to breaking it, like one man away. They had the wedge in the middle, but the back didn't get to the wedge. Somebody came off the edge and made the play. There, they used the sideline return. Did a great job, and that's where your special teams come into play.
State record kickoff return for a touchdown by Mike Serio, officially 91 yards. Miller gets it through. And with Serio's return of 91 yards, he breaks Tom Bart's record from Schaumburg of 85. And more importantly for him right now, his team has a 6-point lead. Here's how it went down.
Here's the record of Tom Bart's old record from Schaumburg High School, about to be broken right here. You can see where he gets the outside return. They had the outside wall set up. Earlier they had used the middle wedge, and this is just a great job right here of getting down that sideline and some great blocks. Right here, turns it outside. He's got a nice wall going right down the sideline.
Tom Bart's kickoff return was a class record of 1999, the overall record prior to the last 30 seconds was 90 yards. So Mike Serio has put his name into the record books. 58 points on the scoreboard. We've had two touchdowns here in about 12 seconds.
And of course, you remember the old record of Brian Weiss in 1986 from Tinley Park that broke one. Go back a long way.
I have a feeling we're not done scoring yet as Brown will take this short kick. Bloomington, boy, a little deflating, huh?
Well, you know what, we're talking about all these records back and forth, and I go home and my wife will say to me, how could you remember 1986 who returned the longest kickoff? You can't remember when my birthday is.
And your response to that is?
Well, you know, I'm trying to pay tuitions.
Bloomington, moments ago, they're feeling the elation of retaking the lead, and their offense trying to get a drink of water, and all of a sudden they come back on the field and they have to fight an uphill deficit again.
But you know what? They got the horses to do it.
They do. Last time it was just a two-play drive. As you're seeing, the reason these teams average 42 and 34 points per game respectively. Option starts it. Nice cut by Wade. That netted him yardage across the 40-yard line. A tackle finally made by Jaron Rutledge, number 55.
Well, they're turning them off. They're playing they're playing zone coverage underneath, which means they don't have to bail out of there and turn their backs and run, and so they can see the ball coming at them, and they come up and they force him to turn inside where they're getting good pursuit from the backside. They're trying to contain Wade's speed, as tough as it may be. Carmel's doing a pretty good job.
Nevertheless, a 7-yard pickup on first down for Wade. He gets it again. Short of the first down and rolled back.
Well, Bloomington has to take advantage of this win. They've got a minute and 30 left, and they've got a speedster in Hughes who already busted one earlier in the quarter. They're going to go up top to him again while they've got this win, because after this, it's going to be tough.
You have about a half a yard short of a first down on third down. They are 5 of 6 in third down conversions today, the Raiders are. They need to get to the 44. They need to get it across that stripe, and they will with Harrison.
Oh,
he gets it
no.
up. Fourth turnover of the day. Jack Simmons, the fumble recovery, the fourth time Bloomington has given it away. And they take it at midfield.
And what incredible situations that they have done that in. And I mean, and I consider that offside to be a turnover at the end of the first half. Here's a replay of this. Harrison on a simple dive, trying to get the extra effort, coughs the football up. Great field position, and again, a short field for Carmel.
They lead it 32-26, the ball 50 yards away from getting another score. To the left side they go, angling off is Mike Serio. He caught his breath after that 91-yard kickoff return. Got about 3, maybe 4 yards. Boy, time for Bloomington defense to dig in. Time for the Carmel offense to really establish themselves on the scoreboard. By far, Carmel's toughest game of the season. By this time in most games, they have put it away. We wind down here in the third quarter. Popovich stretches near the 40. That's where he needs to get for the first down. He'll be very, very close.
What a difference a year makes when we think back to this game last year when Bloomington was in it against Mont Carmel. This year they're against Carmel, but what a difference. I mean, they just didn't have their game. It was just not a well-played football game, unfortunately, by Bloomington, but it was a great well-played game by Mont Carmel. And now we're looking at a ball game which is just tit for tat, back and forth through the whole entire ball game. Two great and well-coached football teams.
That far from a first down. The wind directly out of the south. Carmel driving right into the wind. They will do that for the next 13 seconds. Rigo Schmelzer. He was denied last year in this championship ball game. In fact, you know, we talk about his incredible record of 105-22. The last 3 years, his season ended in the playoffs with his only loss of the season. They will wind the clock and Carmel will just let it go.
Well, what's interesting is one of their goals is always to have at least 2 10-minute drives in a game. And they certainly in this quarter have done a great job, because they have forced Bloomington now to throw into the win in the fourth quarter.
We've finished 3 quarters here in the Class 6A state championship. The Carmel Corsairs 32, Bloomington 26.
Welcome back to Champaign. Carmel leads Bloomington here in the 6A state title game as we begin the fourth quarter. Former Bloomington quarterback Andre Brown played on this field a year ago. You guys never were this close, were you, except for the start of the game?
Nope. It was a struggle last year, both offensively and defensively. These guys this year, they prepared well. Coaches got them ready. And they're out here doing a hell of a job.
32-26, fourth, you were holding up four fingers. Fourth quarter, you know these guys can come back and do it.
Yeah, fourth quarter, Bloomington's notorious for playing in the fourth quarter and being able to come back and handle business in the crunch time.
You it seems to me like by watching you, you have a lot invested in this game. You want these guys to win to kind of make up maybe for last year.
It's been a long time in the making, you know. Being able to come back and see these guys play in a state championship and be able to play like they're playing right now, it's really special considering that we went to the semifinals as a junior and then to state last year. It seems like we get better each year, and I think this year is the time we're going to take the next step.
All right, Andre, thanks a lot, buddy. Andre Brown, former Bloomington quarterback, now at Northern Illinois. Could see him in a Huskies jersey in a couple of years.
Sounds good.
Back upstairs.
And he is pulling for his defense right now, who comes up with a big play right there on John Popovich. It was Eric Miller, number 64, that just met Popovich head on.
Well, what's interesting, Eric Miller, 6 foot, 190-pound junior, is a two-way player for Bloomington, and he had great penetration, and that's one of the keys to stopping this kind of an offense. If you get good penetration, throws off the timing, the misdirection, and he certainly did a great job on that play.
Second down and 12 now for the Corsairs from Carmel. Popovich with room up the middle, and he makes the most of it. Inside the 25 and a first down. Popovich with that run will pop the 100-yard mark in rushing today. That's a 16-yard carry.
He is really a tough inside runner. I mean, he runs between the tackles. He lowers those shoulders. He's got good feet. What we mean by that is he's not extremely fast, but he's got quick feet, and he can make a nice short cut on traps and inside dives and does a nice job of running between the tackles.
15 carries, 111 yards for Popovich. And he has it down to the 15.
That's the exact same play, only in the other direction on a trap. And I don't know if our viewers at home were able to see this, but part of that resulted in Sloan's fake after it. You can watch right here, the guard pulling right here. Here's a trap, he cuts back behind it. And you'll see coming into your screen right here, on 27 is thrown off by the backs faking all the way down the field. Those fakes actually take defenders away from the play. And, you know, it takes a lot of hustle on the part of the ball carriers and a lot of discipline to follow through with your fakes.
Well, as Andy Bitto says, a fake is as good as a block in this offense. Second and short. And they are starting to tackle the man without the ball. This option offense really getting in gear right now as Mike Serio takes it inside the 10.
The other part of that is what a nice job John Sloan is doing with the faking on this. You know, for a young man that hasn't been a starter, watch this right here. Good ride in there, pulls it out, gives it to the second back through, and then he continues out on the perimeter with his fake. Nice job of ball handling right there by John Sloan, 6'1", 180 pounds. After today, will probably be known as Cinderella. What a story.
First and goal inside the 10. Popovich. Logs in number 74, biggest man, just throws it back. Popovich said, wait a minute, where's my ball? Where's the ball? See where they give him progress to, probably about the 6-yard line. 9:20 to play in the game. It's a 32-26 lead for Carmel. Looking to maintain that number one ranking. That's where they've been all season long. They finished the regular season number one in Class 6A. Bloomington was number 9.
What a great job that offensive line of Carmel's been doing. Dan Osterhout, number 79, 69, Drew Cario Gross, 77, Eddie Adamowski, 59, Luke Krombach, and 67, Paul Lyons. That front five have been doing a tremendous job for Carmel.
On second and goal, Solon, he'll keep it to the 5. Third down and goal from the 5-yard line. Oh, some weapons to go to here. You have a 6'5" receiver, tallest man on the field. That would be Jack Simmons. You have two pops here inside the 5-yard line. You lead it by 6 points. Solon gets the play call, and back into the huddle he goes. I'll tell you about that MK on the helmets in a moment. Seen that on the Carmel helmets. Very significant today.
Well, they're matching up Hughes on Simmons, man to man over there in the corner.
Here it comes. Touchdown. This is Chris Miller, the tight end.
Carmel with the 38-26 lead. Solon throwing for his second touchdown of the day.
That's a great call because they put Simmons on the other side of the field to get the safety to help with the corner and double coverage on him. And then they had the wing run straight out to the flat and they brought the tight end underneath. Great call, great execution.
Miller pulls in his seventh touchdown catch of the season.
Fake it, two people, wide open.
Easy, Hieronymus, that coming from Simmons. 2 points, the 40-point mark has been reached, and it's a 14-point lead for the Corsairs from Carmel over Bloomington.
Okay, up here's the matchup that everybody thinks they're going to. Here's the guy that's going to get it right there. They're going to run him out in the flat here, and he's going to come right in behind him. And a little play action fake, and he's going to be wide open right there. There he is right in the corner, folks. Nice job of giving a different look to the field and bringing the tight end up underneath. Great play call, great execution.
Bloomington has had the ball 8 times today, 8 possessions, 4 touchdowns, 4 turnovers. And this last turnover converts into yet another score, third of the day for Bloomington. Turnover leading to a Carmel touchdown. Harrison, not much room there, gives some ground.
But there's more room over here. Oh, nice tackle.
On the tackle was Despain. He's been in on a number of stops. That was an important one, Matt Despain. For Carmel. You know, I was telling you about the MKs in the back of the Carmel helmets. Not every player has them. The offensive players have them. And what's significant about that is it stands for Marshall Kayat. Now, Marshall Kayat would have been the sophomore quarterback for Carmel this season, but tragically, Marshall was killed in a motorcycle accident this past June. The significance as it relates to this game, Kayat would have been the quarterback had Venegoni got down, but when Kayat tragically lost his life, Andy Biddle went to John Solon and said, John, we know we had penciled you in to play defense this year. We'd like you, though, to be our backup quarterback. John Solon, the Cinderella story continues as on the day, he has rushed for 3 touchdowns and passed for 2, and a year ago, he would have been on the defensive side of the ball.
Well, there's the drive that we had, and you can see it doesn't take long, 5 minutes, but that eats up a lot of clock. And they take a 10-play drive, and that was great execution on the touchdown.
That's Justin Harrison making his way off the field. This may be the first play he has missed in the playoffs.
He is one tough football player. Illinois is really getting a great recruit from Justin Harrison. Here's the first play of the game. We saw this play to Hughes. The bubble screen. Fumbles.
Carmel football. The 5th Bloomington turnover of the day. The recovery made by Jim Magna. Magna, the fumble recovery. 5 turnovers today forced by that Carmel defense. Last week it was 6 in the semifinal win over Manuka.
All they do is this is the first or second play they ran in the offense. It's a bubble screen out here to get him out on the perimeter with that great speed. He gets out there, but he just doesn't put the ball away. And there it is right there on the ground. Carmel with a lot of pursuit and a lot of people near the football. They make the play. You can see him trying here to make a big play, but a great job there ripping the ball apart. Carmel comes up with the football.
Corsairs looking to go for the jugular here. Go to the fullback up the middle. Now with 7 minutes and under 30 seconds to play in this game, Carmel will look to grind some clock away.
Well, the last drive lasted 10 plays and 5 minutes. So if they do as well on that, and they'll be taking their time here on the clock. You know, you have 25 seconds to get the ball in play. They'll milk it down to about 5 seconds left on that and run it. Double reverse. He's gone.
There's room.
Ooh!
Steve Hieronymus will stretch it out inside the 25.
Golly, I thought he was gone. It really closed up quickly because he really had two blockers out there, and the defender made a great play to close him in.
40 points on the scoreboard for Carmel. You know, they've not scored less than 35 since week number two. This marks the 10th time they have gone over that 40-point mark, 40 points or better.
That's an amazing statistic when you consider the schedule that they've played. They have not played patsies. They have played a very, very difficult schedule.
Now they will take as much time off the play clock as they can. Fresh set of downs inside the 25.
Well, advantage is they have the clock from college looking right into the quarterback, knows how much time is left before he has to snap it.
Solon.
Oh, he loses it.
There is a costly turnover for Carmel with 6:14 left. John Solon wide open, and it's stripped away. Fumble recovery made by Dan Petty as he made his way downfield.
Well, John Sloan does a great job here on the option. He cuts up inside and just gets the ball knocked away. He's wide open. He could have taken it down to the end zone or certainly inside the 5-yard line. Bloomington makes the opportune play, and the ball will come out to the 20, first and 10, Bloomington.
That may have been Cody Thompson that stripped the ball away from Solon. 6:14 left in this game. Bloomington trailing by two touchdowns. They can do it in a hurry. Going against the wind here, however. First time Peden's kept in the option. It'll be second down, about 2 yards to go for Peden.
Well, we can see here, we're looking at the stats right now. The turnovers, a plus 13 for Carmel. And today has been the big difference. You can see it right there. Five by Bloomington, only one by Carmel. And the scoreboard kind of indicates that. They've been very opportunistic.
Harrison not in the ball game for Bloomington. Wade trying to get to the corner. Will not do it. He's got enough for the first down. James Luby with the tackle. Luby had a big tackle earlier in this game, tracking Wade down in a long run.
This is okay with Carmel.
Yes.
For them to grind it out like this and eat the clock up.
Clock on the move with 5:25 to play.
As we know, Bloomington's strength is not throwing the football. It's their running game, but they're spreading them out here in a passing down, passing formation. Run the option.
Needs one block there. Flag goes down. Wade brought down by Billy Maloney. This flag was thrown behind Wade just as Wade was being tackled.
Could be a hold. Yep.
This will make it tougher for the Purple Raiders. Their fans haven't had a lot to yell about here in the recent moments. They trailed 19-14 at the half, Bloomington did. They came back to take the lead on a couple of occasions.
Block in the back, 10 yards, out of the foul. Repeat first down.
These officials certainly do a great job in this entire championship series. They really are kind of in a scenario where they're in control of the game, but yet you don't know they're there.
Mm-hmm.
And this, to me, is a sign of a great official and a great crew.
Eight different crews come down from all parts of the state. Peden can't handle it. It's free.
Carmel again.
Free no longer. Sixth turnover of the day. James Larson, the fumble recovery.
He just never got the ball from center there. He pulled out so fast. Let's watch the quarterback center exchange right here as it's coming up. You can see him starting to pull out, and it just never comes up. The center was so intent on blocking that defensive lineman that jumped in the gap that he left to go forward before the ball was coming back. And that is not an uncommon fumble between the exchange with the center and the quarterback when that does happen.
See the yardage domination by Bloomington. However, six turnovers have a way of evening that out. And here's Popovich for the score. John Popovich, 16-yard touchdown run, 46-26. Carmel staring their first state championship in the face.
Well, Popovich is getting all the credit there, but I'll tell you, from a coaching standpoint, the credit is due to that offensive line. They are doing a great job up front and opening up some great holes. There's a picture of old veteran Bill Mack. I shouldn't say that, makes it sound like he's tut. No, he's not. He's just a grizzled coach.
Miller's kick is good. And Carmel has hit the 47-point mark with 4:54 to play in this game. You are watching Class 6A State Championships. Carmel, big on top of Bloomington. Four second-half touchdowns for Carmel has enabled them to pull away from a 19-14 halftime lead. In fact, been able to overcome a Bloomington lead here in the second half. That's not a very long drive there. That's not your 10-play drive. That's a one-play drive. 5 seconds, 16 yards for Popovich. His first touchdown of the day, and John Popovich now with 19 carries and 140 yards.
Well, he's been the catalyst thus far in this game and an entire season as far as the way they run this offense with his toughness inside. I can't believe they lost the ball again here.
Near the 5-yard line, and Carmel with it. The seventh turnover of the game is John Hamron. I don't know if you ever saw it. It hit him right in the face mask, and up with the ball is Steve Hieronymus. There you go.
Well, you know, this wind is extremely strong, Dave, and it could have floated on him at the last second. You can look at it right here. It does. It kind of rolls up on him a little bit and hit him right in the face mask. And now he loses the ball completely. And, of course, Carmel's hustling down the field. Looks like a top spinning around. And there's the football, and Carmel's got it on the 4-6-yard line. Popovich again.
That's less than 5 seconds. Put it on the board. Carmel has cracked the 50-point mark. 53-26.
Now I'm going to make a statement that sounds stupid. You look at that score and you say this wasn't a close ball game. This was a relatively close ball game, but a very exciting offensive ball game from both standpoints.
You look back, of course, the last two turnovers leading to two-play touchdowns here, but then you throw in Mike Serio's 91-yard kickoff return. You got a little bit of everything here. Miller again makes it 54-26.
Well, you know, Joliet Catholic won the state championship game just prior to this game, and he said they have one of the greatest attacks I've seen in a long time. And here's the right here. It's just a trap inside to John Popovich for 6 yards and a touchdown. But Dan Sharp said they have a great offense, and they have proven that today. They're outstanding.
There you see Mark Venegoni. He's the quarterback, the All-State quarterback, the broken left ankle. And he's saying, yep, I'm going to put a ring on that finger. 4 second drive. If you're looking for most points scored by a single team in a state championship game, we are 2 points shy of that. Naperville Central in 1999 with 56 points in the 6A state championship game. If you're looking at both teams combined, 87. That was in that championship game against Schaumburg. Naperville Central defeating Schaumburg 56-31. Right now we are at 80 points. We still have time, a lot of time. 4:44 to play. Line drive kick by Miller. Wade. Now those brown jerseys really starting to swarm. Injured player down for the Purple Raiders at the 20-yard line. Well, Jeremy Peden has thrown two interceptions, and Bloomington has fumbled and lost 5 times.
That's Bryce Hennenberg, one of the offensive linemen, 5'8", 185-pound junior. Good to see he's up and walking off on his own power.
Well, we expect to see some fireworks coming up later tonight. That in the 8A state championship game, Jack McInerney, and I will be back for that one. That's when Lockport will take on Maine South. And if you like your running, well, this was the game to come and see. But if you like your passing attack, you make sure you come back at 7 o'clock for the 8A championship game. And, of course, immediately following this, the 7A championship, Libertyville in Oswego. James Wade converts through. A flag goes down behind Wade. Brandon Hughes spins around. He's on his knees at about the 35-yard line. He may be flagged here on an illegal block. James Wade on the day prior to that carry. He carried the ball 20 times for 152 yards. He was looking to atone for what he considered a subpar performance last year in the state championship game, and he actually had a fractured wrist.
He's run very hard today. He is a good high school running back.
This penalty will go against Carmel. Howard Owens, our referee, informs the crowd. We'll get the explanation here in a moment after he talks to quarterback Jeremy Peden.
Legal use of hands on the receiver here. 10 yards, first down.
Your home for everything you want to know about the Illinois High School Association is right there at IHSA.org. You can get, if you're at home watching, click on that, get your immediate statistics for this ball game and for every one of the 8A games. And of course, follow each and every one of the sports all season long on www.ihsa.org. The ball into Carmel territory. Wade looking for a block. Can't quite get it, and he will be rolled out of bounds inside the 40. Justin Harrison, you saw him injured a few minutes ago on a kickoff. He has not yet returned to this ball game. He plays the fullback spot. Eric Tapley manning that position right now for the Purple Raiders as both teams trying to get some new players into this game. 4:16 to play. Wade getting every carry now. Little guy gets it to about the 23-yard line. You know, I don't know how little you can say James Wade is. 5'8", 175. He packs it in on a pretty solid frame. He came in rushing for 2,095 yards. And after that carry, he now has 199 yards in this game. He had 194 in the semifinals. What a great performance by Wade today.
Well, they just run that stretch lead, and they've run that several times, and they let him pick where he wants to go, and he just reads the shoulders of the defensive lineman, and he cuts in or dips out, and he's done a fine job of that all afternoon.
The pitch to Wade. He's not going to get his 200 yards there. Well, depending on the spot of the ball, he may have it.
See, with that particular play, Carmel does not want, they're isolating right now. When they run that up, when they run the option, they're coming right now and taking the pitch man. They're saying, okay, if you want to run with it, let the quarterback run with it. That's why they're that he's not getting any running room on the perimeter.
You know, some incredible numbers. We'll recap the statistics following this game, but as of right now, Bloomington has averaged 8.6 yards per offensive play, and yet they trail by 4 touchdowns. Wade around the corner, stretching it. Has his 200-yard game and has it to a third down about 6. Any reuse of this broadcast without the express written consent of the Illinois High School Association and cost broadcast sales is strictly prohibited. Coming up immediately following our ball game, that's right, you've got the 7A championship, Oswego and Libertyville. Get ready for that one. Libertyville can score some points. Oswego will hammer you. And then the Class 8A game, maybe the most talked about game, Maine South taking on Lockport. Those two teams are combined to win 2 of the last 3 8A championships. You will see the 2 best quarterbacks in the state. They are both juniors, Sean Price and Jake Christensen. Here's yet another fumble. Who's going to come up with it?
Carmel's got it, I think.
Oh, my. 8th turnover of the day for Bloomington. fumble recovery goes to number 54, actually Jeremy Henson on the fumble recovery. It is a short drive back to Bloomington, but it could be a long one tonight for the Raiders.
Well, they're running the lead option. He just pitches it too far. He never gets down on the ball and just keep kicking it around. And right there, Carmel comes up with it right on Bloomington's sideline.
A title game record for fumbles. Revis, the previous record holder, and Bloomington has the dubious distinction now, their sixth lost fumble of the day.
And that ball was fumbled on the snap right there. We've got a whole new offensive group in here for Carmel.
Under 2 minutes to play as both coaches looking to get different players into the game. Get yourself down on this Memorial Stadium turf. There are your turnover numbers for the day. Coming in, Bloomington at plus four, now minus eight. 6A championship game record. Revis in 1981 gave it up four times by way of fumbles. Today, six. Ouch. New quarterback into the ball game for Carmel, John Brennan, a freshman. Now you're scrambling. If you're a head coach, you're scrambling, saying, okay, well, who haven't we gotten in? You know, who can get in here? We need a lineman. Give me a tackle. Give me a tackle. I need a tackle.
Well, the other part of that is you don't think that all these people in the stands are saying, put my kid in, put my kid in. So you're dealing with a lot of people screaming in your ears.
And now we'll see another quarterback into the game, Tyler Enkney. He's a sophomore. The offense remains the same. And if they can squeeze one more play, there will be about six more players coming in. And in fact, the players that will be coming in,
they're going to punt with the wind.
Yeah, they're going to bring their punting team on. And let's see. Yep, they will get this punt off, and that will be it. So Andy Bitto and the Carmel Corsairs will claim their first state championship, 54-26. Is the score. They will let the clock wind down and probably take a delay of game penalty. It doesn't matter. We'll freeze the clock here with 3 seconds left. A long trip from Mundelein is a happy one indeed. The Corsairs to go 14-0 came into the season ranked number one, not only in their class, but in the entire Chicagoland area for the entire season. They're going to walk away with a dominating victory here, taking advantage of eight turnovers on the day by Bloomington. You wonder, what can Andy Bitto say? Okay, now we have 3 seconds left, guys. He's one of the few head coaches, by the way, that coaches his special teams as well as, you know, being the head coach. That was a very nervous sideline about 45 minutes ago.
Well, they have a juggernaut of an offense, and they knew it, and other people knew it, and it was just a matter of how long before they got on track, and it didn't take long.
Chris Miller will just go down and take a knee, and that will end it. So the Carmel Corsairs become your Class 6A state champions, and they will carry Mark Venegoni, their quarterback, a broken ankle, onto the field to celebrate, and he is as happy as any of the other men dressed in brown and gold. His replacement, John Solon, the junior, 3 rushing touchdowns on the day, 4 of 4 passing for 2 more scores on the day, and Carmel puts a stamp on their 2003 season with the 54-26 win.
It was quite a performance by both teams, but certainly by Carmel's offense. We had heard so much about it. And certainly up in the Chicago area, they were ranked number one for most of the year. And people, every time they saw them, they said they're amazing, and they certainly proved to be that.
Let's go downstairs to Lee Hall. Lee?
All right, we're with head coach Andy Bitto. Coach, what a courageous effort by your young guys. Mark Venegoni out of the game. John Solon stepped in and ran the show for you today.
Well, at halftime, I told the kids that these guys, we got to prevent the big play, and our defense got three or four turnovers in the second half. And then John Solon ran the machine. Our offense has been scoring a ton of points, but our second-team quarterback comes in and plays like that. It really is credit to him, and our offensive line has been outstanding all year, and that's why we've been able to get so many yards offensively.
It was a great sign I saw on the sideline there in the closing moments. Your offensive lineman came over and all bear hugged Mark Venegoni, what he meant to this team this year.
And you know what? He has been such an inspiration to all of us, and I can't tell you, he's got such an internal combustion about him that he transcended it even in practice when we knew he wasn't going to play, and it was just a tremendous leadership effort from a guy who can't walk.
An incredible thing. You'd never been in the state championship before, now you win one.
I tell you what, it's probably 10 years from now before it sinks in, but it's an amazing feeling, and I'm so proud of our kids and so proud of our community, and we've worked real hard for this, and Bloomington gave a great effort. We got lucky and got a bunch of turnovers and converted on them. I'm so proud of our kids.
All right, Coach, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
All right, back upstairs to you.
Not so sure that when you get 8 turnovers, it's all luck. Your defense last week forced 6 turnovers in a semifinal game, and you know, whether it's the defensive pressure, the pursuit to the ball, they made them kick it up 8 times today, 6 by way of fumble and 2 interceptions.
Well, you know, when you have an offense like Carmel's, their defense is obviously overshadowed the entire year because the offense is so productive and there's so many pluses and all the highlights are going to the offense, but that defense has done a great job all year and certainly did do it today because Bloomington had a lot of threats offensively coming into this game, and Carmel for the most part really shut them down.
It's a tradition at Carmel, they, following a ball game, they line up on the goal line on one knee, and in a few moments they will break out of that and they will head down to the south end of this stadium where they will claim their medallions designating them as Class 6A champions in 2003. You know, if we look at the Bloomington side, you know, they feel like last year, you know, 31-0, we felt like we didn't give our best performance in a loss to Mount Carmel, but this year they come away with a much more solid performance, and let's go back downstairs to Lee Hall.
All right, thanks a lot, Dave. We are with our country insurance player of the game. John Solon steps in for an injured Mark Venegoni and leads his team to a championship. Tell me about the feeling right now.
This is great. You know, Mark's probably one of the best players on our team, and I mean, if he was to score, probably would have been doubled, but I mean, I had to step in for him just this week, and I think I did all right.
3 touchdown runs, 3 touchdown passes, not a bad job for a backup.
Yeah, I guess.
Tell me about the offensive line. Those guys don't get a lot of kudos, but when you're coming in there as a backup and you have this kind of game, you got to give some props to them, right?
Oh, yeah, I mean, Eddie, Dan, Luke, Paul, Drew, I mean, they're all great. I mean, they're all leaders. I mean, I just followed them.
Mark was pretty much an inspiration to you there on the sidelines, wasn't he? He was kind of pumping you up all game.
Oh, yeah, he was.
All right, good luck. Congratulations to you.
Thank you.
All right.
I'm not so sure John Solon understands that he was playing in a state championship game. That's a pretty calm young man there for somebody that's won a big championship with the numbers that he did. Yeah, I was talking about Bloomington moments ago as we take a look at the Carmel fans and John Popovich, but you know, you can say 8 turnovers, boy, what a disappointing performance, but Bloomington came in here today, and you know what, from the first snap, they showed that they meant business today, and had it not been for the turnovers, we obviously would not have seen a 28-point difference.
Well, there's really no doubt about that. They had an outstanding season, and it's just unfortunate that it had to come down to the last ball game of the year where they had the most mistakes they've had in the previous 13 games. I don't think a culmination of turnovers for the entire year added up to what they had today. And it's really a shame when it comes down to the biggest game of their careers.
As far as Carmel is concerned, one thing that they have done this year is they have worn teams down. They have made their big push late in the ballgame. In fact, a lot of times Carmel, their first quarter and a half, you'd say, okay, this is the top-ranked team, and then they just come on hard from there, and that's exactly what they did today, though they did give us some thrills early. Bloomington on to the podium as we return to Memorial Stadium, high atop Memorial Stadium. We're still very chilly in terms of the wind blowing around here, but nothing like it was yesterday. But right now down the field, Carmel, the kids, those kids don't feel anything.
They don't. Well, you know, they don't, and they've had a tremendous year. They've played great competition. Oftentimes people say, well, who did they play? Well, you look at their schedule, and if you know football in the Chicago area, you know that they played on a tremendous schedule, and they did extremely well. I mean, they averaged 38 points a game, and then certainly in the last five or six, they've been in the 40s. And, of course, today, in the biggest game of all, they score 54. So they're all they're cracked up to be.
You know where else they are smiling? They're smiling in the East Suburban Catholic Conference, because here in the span of, about 2-3 hours, they have crowned two state champions out of their conference. In Class 5A, Joliet Catholic Academy hung on today to defeat Springfield Sacred Heart Griffin 27-24 in the 5A game. And here, the top finishing team in East Suburban Catholic, Carmel, comes away with the big win over Bloomington as the Purple Raiders get their medallions that will mean much more to them as time goes on. And right now, it's no consolation, you know, when they get the handshake and they will be presented the trophy behind them. But see Brandon Hughes, number 17 there, what a thrill he gave us early. James Wade, his final numbers after that last fumble on 192 yards rushing as Purple Raiders, not what they were after, but for the second year in a row, they will bring back the second place trophy in Class 6A back to Bloomington.
Well, it's really a shame when two teams come into this game with a combined record of 26-0, and one of them has to leave disappointed. And, you know, it's easier for us adults to tell these teenagers that, you know, there's a tomorrow and you'll always wake up tomorrow and there's another day. But right now, this emotion is very, very difficult for them to comprehend after all they've done.
For the third straight year, their season ends, Bloomington's season ends with a loss in the playoffs, second season in a row. Their perfect season ends with a loss in the state championship ball game. As far as Carmel is concerned, well, they came down here one time and they won it one time. And that's something that Andy Bitto, you know, as he said, it might sink in 10 years. I have a feeling it might sink in a little bit later on this weekend. But what a great situation as far as Carmel is concerned. Their fans have really gotten behind them. And now they can kind of relax a little bit. Now, you know, I don't know if Andy's going to relax all that much, because his brother Alex is an offensive line coach for Oswego. Those teams are getting set to play in a 7A game, so maybe Andy will enjoy it for about a half an hour and then come out and watch his brother.
Well, I'll tell you what, his brother's done a great job with the offensive line with Oswego. I saw him last week, and they are outstanding. We've got some great football still ahead of us. We saw it today, and there's a squad right there. There's a sign of a kid. I really feel bad for him. I mean, he's excited now because his team has won, and, you know, he's been caught up in the emotion of it. But tomorrow, he's going to say, you know, I missed out on the biggest game that I could have ever have played in, and who knows what I could have done. And, you know, it's, you got to kind of feel sorry for a kid like that, because that's a memory that he won't have as far as playing in this game.
They're already getting sized up for their rings. Obviously, that's a big deal. Of course, Jack McInerney with his ring from a couple of years ago in Downers Grove South. Jack Simmons, you see him standing up there. Yeah, you see, it'll go right there, and I don't want it to fall off. I don't want it to fall off. And, you know, you look at Benigoni, the thing that I like about him is he had that eye black on today. He was ready to be part of this one with the eye black.
He was in it emotionally and in any way he could to encourage his teammates. And watching him on the sidelines, he was limping up and down, encouraging them as they came on and off the field.
You know, one of the toughest things for a team to do is to be ranked number one in the preseason and then have to live up to that every single game. But they did, 14 games. That state championship trophy is yours.
That's a great shot.
And how many people dream of doing that very thing? In fact, Luke Krombach, offensive lineman for Carmel, said, "This is my childhood dream, to come down here to play for the state championship." Luke, your dream has been realized. Almost anticlimactic as they walk off the podium here in the south end of Memorial Stadium. But if you're looking for many good things coming up, you stay right there. You've got the 7A game coming up, Oswego and Libertyville, followed by the 8A championship. That will be Maine South and Lockport. Great day of football awaits you. A great 6A game. Carmel, your 6A champs, 54-26 over Bloomington.